Welcome to the Cultaholic Wrestling Podcast.
If you like a lot of wrestling on YouTube, join our cult. Hello and welcome to the wonderful world of Cultaholic, where we all get along and we're all good friends. If you don't believe me, please ask my close personal friend, Ross on Wrestling, a proud Team Ross representative, and the bastard, Jack.
Second time,
Matthew, that's wrong.
What did I say?
Team Ross. You said Team Ross. We're going to keep going with this one, otherwise we'll be here
Mate,
all day.
I'm sorry.
It was me, it was Adam, it was Owen on
I
Team Owen.
I killed it. Because then I think it was going to be really nice to you and then go, and here's the bastard who's rolled his sleeves up for some reason.
I do that
as soon
all
as I was
the
talking
time.
About him.
I do that all the time.
The cheat and get, the Randy Orton ruining Drew McIntyre's push, Mr. Jack, Cultaholic champion.
No. King. No, see, the belt hasn't changed. The belt's
Matthew,
vacant
Matthew, it's fine
now.
That you don't watch what we do. It's fine.
I asked Owen who won, and he said you did.
This is so book report at the last minute when you've not read it. This is incredible.
I asked him.
Right, Matthew,
I don't watch it because none of you bastards invited me, so I went to bed instead.
We didn't have a party. We're all in our individual houses.
I was on the outside crying my eyes out.
So this is what happened, right? It was Team Owen, which was Ross, Adam, and Owen. And Team Me, which was me, Tom, and Sam. Now, because we won, that means the belt is going to go to one of us three, but that'll be decided at TLC. And I didn't screw Owen. I'm just better than him at predicting fake fighting on YouTube.
So when I asked Owen who's the champ, and he said, Jack is... All right, cool, 2 seconds. Owen signed, making me look like a fanny. Well done, Jack. It's good to see you on Team Maffew then. Oh, happy to have you back, my good personal friend. How
That's
the hell
all right. That's okay.
That wasn't the intro I was expecting to do, by the way, in case you're wondering.
You sound like Kenny. Is there a lag? Have I gone? Am I still
heard
there?
I you. I just didn't get it. What?
Oh, my close personal friend. It's what Kenny says about everybody.
Oh, my close personal friend. Yeah, he says it about, but like, he says it about like Undertaker, Sting, like all of that.
Oh, right. So it's definitely accurate in this case as well.
Yeah.
So let's start afresh. How the hell are you, Ross?
I am disgruntled after the announcement yesterday that the tiers are back here in the UK. Newcastle's been put in the worst one. If I had kids, I could take them to school. They could go and frolic around the playground with their pals and whatever. Then I could take them for a haircut in the middle of town. I can take them around Primark where there's no social distancing, but I couldn't take them out for a meal or go around to my parents to see them or something like that. It makes no sense and I'm disgruntled. It's finally cracked. My morale has cracked in this lockdown era. How the hell are you two doing? Because I'm doing rough. It's finally happened. It's taken this long, but finally I feel miserable due to lockdown.
I think you're allowed to be Ross, though. So you are miserable for completely legitimate reasons. So.
I'd be all right if it made sense, but none of it makes any sense. It's just Boris taking care of his pals down in London and fobbing off the rest of the country. Tory prick. Get their minds back open. Down with Thatcher.
I don't want to be all like, nobody looks out for the Northeast, like, but... Michael Potts, who we used to work with at What Culture, who now I think writes for the Radio Times down in
He's
London.
He's the sports editor, I believe, aye.
Bloody hell. Fair play to him. He made a very good point on Twitter saying that if you look at other regions, they're broken down into like minuscule, like Manchester's broken down into City Manchester, Greater Manchester, Bury, Oldham, like whatever. There's all the different little bits that it's broken down into. Northeast's just Northeast, Tier 3, see us later. And I know that we live in the city, so we would be in Tier 3 anyway, but it's a bit harsh on the
Northumberland.
The people from right. up Ross's way and everything, yeah.
I was born in a field, in a barn. That's all that's there in Northumberland. They're like, locked down as well.
Like Jesus.
There's more sheep than there are people in Northumberland, man, and they're locked down as well. None of it makes any sense. But people come for these podcasts to get away from the issues in the world, and I already regret springing it all up, but I couldn't hold it in.
Matthew, how are you?
Oh, I'm fabulous after hearing that. And I think we would be amiss to not mention anything like this because it means, for the people watching this, that yes, the wonders of doing podcasts over Zoom or Discord or if a better app gets invented will be continuing. Ross will drop something on his keyboard for the next few weeks just to spite us all. And yeah, I am keeping myself mentally strong by going for jogs. And weirdly enough, though, going by what it means that we can do in the tiers... None of my friends are close relatives wanted to do anything that involved a pub, a restaurant, or a sporting event anyway, when we could do it. So it's literally the same thing as I've been doing the past few months anyway. I will be walking to Leisure's Park with my big raincoat on, feeding the ducks, and that will be the highlight of the week. And I'm looking forward to seeing the ducks. We've got friends now. Got a thing going.
Join us on my podcast
where I ruin everybody's name at the start where they do the Cultaholic Team Owen thing, and they went, that sounds crap, Matthew. Don't do that. And I went, oh, what do you ducks know? Yeah, sure listened. But yeah, we should move away from the weird, weird world of reality and the weird, weird world of wrestling instead. Oh. First of all, some happy news. Xavier Woods has become a presenter for the returning G4 brand. What's gaming thing in America, I don't understand.
The choir lads from X Factor.
Yeah, them lads. Oh, God, when they covered Bohemian Rhapsody. Was that them?
I think so, yeah. Well, they were called G4, weren't they?
Yeah.
You sunk my battleship.
To be fair, though, it was Woods.
Okay.
Yeah. I saw, who was it? It was Woods starting one of his Twitch streams with Adam Cole and Cesaro. They were all singing there, so maybe that could have been the start of a brand new American G4, also involving Tyler Breeze, who couldn't have been there for personal reasons or something. There was just a picture of Tyler Breeze. He wasn't singing with the rest of them.
I love those four. The Party, they're called. The Party. And they know how to as well. Let me tell you, they're called G4 now. Right, sorry. Yes. But formerly, they knew how to party. Now they sing opera. I thought when you said G4, I got reminded of that song, Like a G6, which reminds me of some terrible establishments in Newcastle from about 10 years ago. Do you remember Basement Trebs Bar?
Yeah.
Oh, brilliant. Good times.
Hi. So he's become a presenter due to his successful hashtag Creed4G4 on social media. And he also won the Esports Content Creator of the Year award for Up, Up, Down, Down.
Oh, so, not us.
Good for them. And I imagine this would be one of these situations where they go, fantastic, love your stuff. What else do you do apart from gaming? They go, I'm a professional wrestler, been on TV. Oh, really? That's cool. We had no idea. Rather, like Sasha Banks joined The Mandalorian. And yeah, I'm happy for him. He's a good nerd. Like those bad nerds you read about, boo hiss. So I see this as a win for the good guys, because obviously me and Xavier Woods have so much in common. Some negative news. Bob Ryder, one of the founders of TNA, passed away this week. To me and other people my generation and older, he's known for best being behind the onewrestling.com news site, which was a big thing in the late 90s. And a lot of people used until they discovered what a pop-up advert was. And it would kill your PC quicker than a dodgy email. So I think it is still around technically, but without pop-ups disabled, I wouldn't dare venture onto it. One Wrestling would lead him to WCW, becoming close with Bischoff. And then when TNA got started, he would do travel and arrangements like that with talent. And yeah, RIP Bob Ryder. One Wrestling meant a lot of things for people, but I realize at this stage, not a lot of people know or care about that type of thing. So I thought I would ask. Ross, what was the first wrestling site that you used or found?
Oh, I've got no idea, because when I first got on the internet, I wasn't watching wrestling. Oh. So my sort of consumption of wrestling started at the start of the last decade, like sort of 2012-ish sort of time. So I'm the wrong person to ask, Matthew, to be honest with you.
That's absolutely fair enough. A good answer. Jack, same question.
Probably 411 Mania.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that I know there was like plenty of sites before that. Like, what's it called? Was Lords of Pain an early one?
I think at the same time, more or less. Right. I don't know the exact right, years, cool. But yeah.
I think 411 was mine because it does those weekly write-ups of Raw and SmackDown, and I wanted to secretly follow the wrestling without anyone knowing. So I'd just scuttle on there, read about what happened, go, who's Mr. Kennedy? And then get off. Yeah.
Oof.
Well, no.
I'm sure he's glad to hear that.
No, the PC was in a communal area of the house. I couldn't. Getting a laptop, game changer. What am I talking about?
I love it. Keep it. Just bury that hole bigger and bigger. Just room for you and a certain mid-carder from 2007. Yeah, and I realise now, though, in a weird way, going, you know, being so long of tooth, as they say, and seeing all the generation changes, that you guys doing the daily news videos here at Cultaholic, you're like the Bob Ryders and Larry Zonkers.
Bloody hell.
The current generation. It was just weird to think of like that.
Yeah, so. It is weird.
Yeah.
God. Bringing shame to the profession.
Yeah. Sorry to them. Yeah. Sorry. Sorry to their memory.
Another news. Doc Gallows is on the shelf for 4 to 6 weeks. So Impact Wrestling said, don't worry. got something to replace him. So Hornswoggle showed up as the wee nominal one, Jay... I can't even say it. Say Jay Swoggle, bloody hell.
Time to fly.
Time to fly, yes. Yeah, just pick him up and throw him. And yeah, and he made an impression by doing a combo, then calling Ethan Page his legit name for some reason on Impact Wrestling. Yeah, and that's their solution, meaning that he's appeared in the space of 1 week on AEW and Impact. He's the next Don Callis.
So, I guess we'll never find out who his dad is after that AEW thing last week. It ended on a cliffhanger, didn't it? Him just crying there in the door. Who's the baby daddy?
Oh, yeah. Oh. Well, it was Vince McMahon.
No, an AEW law. It can't be Vince McMahon, can it?
Wow.
Oh, using WCW logic, it's going to be Virgil, isn't it? The other Vincent.
Was it proven not to be Vince in the end as well? Didn't they retcon it and go, no, that never happened? He wasn't really. Or am I thinking of...
I've repressed all memory of that angle.
Am I thinking of Dominic and Eddie?
No, and Finlay came out and said, no, actually, he's mine.
Finlay
and then he battered JBL, because JBL was beating him up. JBL had that match with Hornswoggle in the cage where he just annihilated him, bless him, and just, you know, follow slam into the cage. Oh, my God. And then Finlay went, I've had enough of this. You're actually my real son. And it was Vince McMahon was never mentioned again.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's Finlay. He needs to show up now.
Yeah.
He's still...
He's just re-signed with WWE, hasn't he?
Oh, right.
Well, don't want AEW using him after that. WWE has... sorted something out with their stockholders after this goes all the way to the Saudi Arabian plane situation, which you all remember being that exciting news story where were they stuck in the country on a plane or were they not? Everybody in WWE seemed to say everything's fine, and then a lot of people were tweeting ambiguous stuff that seemed to say that they were very happy to be out of the country in one piece. Because of not disclosing potentially negative information, which led to the purchase of stock at artificially inflated prices, they've had to pay out some $39 million, subject to court approval. So, yeah, here comes the money. The settlement will also include full release for all defendants and will contain no admission of liability or admission or truth regarding the allegations. So, look, we're not saying if it was true or not, but here's $39 million.
Shut your mouths and take our money, you dirty scallywags.
Absolutely. And... in other news, John Moxley appeared on Renee's podcast to talk about how he used to do cocaine and then go to the library to read books.
Really? I didn't listen to this.
Have you not seen this? Oh, no. It's amazing.
Wow.
Well, do some coke and read a book. And she's laughing going, what? That's some book.
Saw the 5-minute clips you put on YouTube was all him just going, oh, I love professional wrestling. If I could wrestle in front of 200 people down at the local rec centre, I would do it. That's how much I would love it. That's how much I love it, sorry. I didn't realise it went that deep. I need to give oral sessions a listen to now.
I can't believe she's called it that.
Oral sessions.
Dirty.
One more time, Ross.
Huh?
One more time.
What's it called? Oral sessions. It's even worse with the moustache, isn't it? Oral sessions.
Some poor lad's going to be on a train listening to this in the headphones and you'll just hear it.
Yeah. The other news, I think we'll pass it. Let's say it in passing. Maradona, RIP.
Mm.
It means a lot to our country for various reasons. I saw the amazing documentary this year when I thought lockdown was only going to be 2 months long. Really enjoyed it. What a talent on that man. But who cares? This side of the world will corner the newspapers, will forever know him as that cheating hand of God bastard.
Well,
what are your football memories of him, Ross?
Well, I'm over that, to be honest with you. That was in 1986, and that was a long time ago, and Peter Shilton and people like that need to give their head a wobble, I guess I would say. We're here on this professional wrestling podcast speaking about an unbelievable footballer, one of the best of all time. Disagree with FIFA's... Oh, somebody's told FIFA to retire the number 10 shirt as we're sat here, and they're considering that apparently.
From everyone?
From everybody.
Whoa.
I guess that would include Messi, who's... And what that means for Pele, I have no idea, but he was all right. Got to keep the wrestling there.
Yeah, who else?
The guy from Dark Order. He was good at football, was Messi, and he also loved the coke.
Yeah.
Maradona.
Oh, sorry, Maradona, not Messi.
For our lawyers, Maradona, not Messi.
He's just like the HDH did Messi.
Now,
Jack, what do you have to say?
Something a bit mythical about Maradona, wasn't there? Because I think the last World Cup he appeared at was the 94 one. So I'd have been very young. Yeah. So I only know him from video, like clips of old matches and stuff. But, oh, what a player. And also, like, because today, right, Messi is a brilliant footballer, but he's kind of, he's not great on the mic. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, he's a great worker, not so good on the mic. Messi, Maradona had both. He could cut a promo. He could wrestle a great match. He could play a good game of football. I think he was, he's quite an icon, isn't he? He's like up there with the likes of Jordan and Muhammad Ali and stuff in the football world. Yeah. Sad.
And
yeah.
in the mafia world. That documentary is unbelievable.
When he was in Napoli. When he was in Napoli.
Yeah, until football screwed him by putting him in a position where he couldn't win. Bloody hell. Yeah, do you mind me scoring against you in this World Cup? Oh, creatures. But anyway, yeah, Maradona, RIP. That's all we have to say about that. Something to do with wrestling coming up next. Oh, no, wait, the Hall of Fame
segment.
Hall
of Fame now.
Next segment, there'll be some wrestling, we promise.
Everybody get excited for the Cultaholic Hall of Fame.
Ah, now it's time for everyone's favourite segment, the Hall of Fame. And in condescending order from last week, Craig David, 14%.
Oh.
Very surprised at that. I thought that would be it. I mean, if people don't remember Craig David, then the entire bit I just talked about onewrestling.com could be whoosh. John Bon Jovi, timeless to some, but not this podcast, 21%.
What's going on?
What demographic are we a part of now? Like, what's our main demographic here? Can't be 18 to 49. It can't be 50 plus. What's going on?
Billie Eilish and that. All the young hip folk. They don't know Craig David and Bon Jovi.
I know. All the kids with hips.
Yeah.
But surprisingly, I did not expect this at all. The Acclaim's pre-match diss track of whoever the hell it was they were wrestling on AEW Dark with the line, "You couldn't get booked for a portrait of your family," 65%. I am astonished. I am very grateful. But what a line.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, I'm devastated at this loss.
Not got
this
the back catalogue of a John Bon Jovi though, has it?
That's it. I claim second diss track's gonna have a lot of hype behind it now. So I guess I'll go first. First time in a while, bloody hell. It was a toss-up between The Undertaker doing his cameo videos, but I think we'll make fun of that later on, and we're doing the Twitch stream on Saturday. It went very well, considering the Sega Saturn emulator I used, which worked fine. For the first time in my life, I've got an emulator working like that. Decided to crap out as soon as the stream started, and I went, this is a bad joke, this. But then we talked and started playing, and people seemed to have fun, because in the chat, having good times. And I realised something that we've mentioned quite a few times on this podcast, but I'd never actually stopped the stream and showed it to people. The Kevin Nash shoot interview that he does in a restaurant. And I thought, you know what, sod it. Because there's a really good video that highlights all the bits of ASMR goodness when he's like, And I just showed that to people. And I just sat back there howling like a dog left outside in the rain for the 5 minutes it was played, because it was just, okay, I mean, everything is funny about it from a production standpoint. Kevin Nash talking to a dude and they're at a restaurant. The framing's slightly off, so there's a painting, like, here, rather than between the two guys, so it's all right. They're in a restaurant to do a shoot interview. Kevin Nash has a microphone to hold, and so he holds it, like, one arm here, so it's poking out, like this, the entire time, in between his legs, like he's an NXT UK cameraman. And then he's eating with this hand and answering questions, but he's not, like, pausing. He's just like, so what was your run like in WCW with Scott Hall? Oh, me and Scott Hall... And it's just the best. It's everything about it is hilarious. And I thought I'd actually show that to people on the Twitch stream, and they watched it and loved it and go, you have to put this in the Hall of Fame this week. So I am. And if you don't believe me how good this was, go and search it. Go and, you know, make sure you tell people in the comments Cultaholic sent me and all this, like they have for the Cilla Black, She's a Journalist video. So yeah.
She's a journalist.
Have you seen that, Ross? I didn't realise that was a thing, a Pacitti era thing, and you went here for the Cilla Black clip.
I've never seen that Cilla Black thing. Did he share it on Twitter? I think I've seen it once, maybe just via that, but yeah, I was never aware of that one.
It's insane. It's like something from like a mafia film. I can't believe it. Yeah. It's so cold.
A Maradona film.
Yeah.
So, what do you want that listed as, by the way, Matthew, on the Patreon page? Kevin Nash, salad? Potato?
It's pasta. Lasagna, isn't it?
Is it lasagna?
Kevin Nash, lasagna. Mud kip.
Mud cape.
That's the pocket.
We are old.
Jesus. Kevin Nash mukbang.
Mud cape.
Nearly so close.
Good starter, water type and ground. Oh, what a powerful combo, though, with Mudkip. Legend.
I might put Mudkip down so people vote for it if you haven't listened to things. Like, oh, I love Pokemon Me, and they vote for it and then get very annoyed when they see next week's podcast. Mm. Let's see. Second place, John Bon Jovi, Ross. What have you got for us?
Mine's a wrestling one this week. Can't believe it. Who would have thought of it? He'll never win. But I was watching this week's NXT, and I found myself ruffling at a sassy Bill Regal, Mr. William Regal himself, who was sort of brought onto the scene by Kevin Owens, who I've thought that entire segment was so weird, how Kevin Owens was just poking fun at all the tropes. And I guess some people might have found it funny. I was just sat there going like, oh, it's not quite doing it for me, but I can see what he's trying to do. But he's like, if only we had a Teddy Long figure to come out here on NXT and book a triple threat match between Leon Ruff and Damian Priest and Johnny Gargano. And then, oh no, here comes Willie Regal. And now, and he just says, player, with a very sassy little afterwards, really, which he always does very, very well. And I was in hysterics when I saw that. So it's sassy William Regal saying player with the added little, ooh, how you do, sir, afterwards.
He's very good. That was Ross is going to win because that was hilarious. It was really good. Have you seen the video where he teases shouting War Games, but he just says, you never see two pretty best friends.
I like that because it took me a few watches to get, like, to figure out what does that mean.
It's a, yeah, I think it was also a recent meme where someone said it as well, but obviously it sounds like an old wise proverb, though, so I thought it was good.
Yeah, that's a good pick. I haven't seen NXT, but I assume it was good just by what you've said. So Jack, that leaves you
last but not least.
Don't head.
What? Strowman took such offence at a nice thing to say.
That was so stupid,
wasn't it?
No wonder the general population doesn't watch wrestling when we've got crap like that happening. Who reacts like that to someone saying last but not least?
Oh. Strowman, is kayfabe Strowman stupid?
Yes.
That's fine. I think that I can sort of excuse it.
His brother is Brain Strowman, remember?
That's like 2015 all over again, bloody hell. I've not heard that one for a while.
Sorry. Jack, what is your pick and why is it Brain Strowman?
No, it's the series Cobra Kai. Because have either of you watched it?
No.
Damn. Have either of you watched the original Karate Kid?
No.
Years ago, yeah.
Did you like it?
Repeat to tell, try and you succeed, crane kick, yeah.
You're the best Wax around. Yeah, all the excellent Bananarama.
Did I have Peter Cetera on there as well?
I don't know. It's got...
Glory of Love. I am a man who will fight for your honor.
Potentially.
What a song that is.
It's got a brilliant soundtrack because it was the 80s. But Cobra Kai is... I mean, have you heard of it? Either of you?
Yeah,
I've heard of it, yeah. Never seen it.
Yeah, it's just... The way they flip it is so good because it focuses at first on Johnny, the bad guy of Karate Kid. And his life's a mess and he's never got out of the 80s, so he drives a red Firebird and he drinks Coors, not Coors Light, some like old school, I don't know what it is, Coors Banquet, I think it's called. It's a weird looking beer. And he listens to hair metal and everything. And it's just so funny because he tries to start a dojo with all like millennials and stuff. So they're all like, like a girl walks in and he's like, sorry, no, girls can't do karate. And the rest are like, no, they can. And he's like, quiet. It's just very, very funny. And then but then you realize he's got a heart and he teaches the kids and it's all a bit School of Rock in that way. But then guess who pops up to try and ruin it? Daniel-san from Karate. Daniel pops up to try and shut it down. Daniel is now a successful car dealer. He chops the competition or something. It kicks the competition. It's very good. I've not sold it well, but anyone who's watched it will know what I'm talking about. It's cheesy and awful, but it's bloody brilliant as well. And they've announced a third season for early next year, I think. So mine is Cobra Kai, which is on Netflix now. There you go.
Lovely. I'm just looking at the soundtrack on IMDb and it's just all the 80s bands. Oh. Survivor, Moment of Truth. The Flirts, Bop Bop on the Beach.
Is this the Karate Kid soundtrack or is this the Cobra Kai soundtrack?
It's the Karate Kid soundtrack.
Cobra Kai's got an 80s soundtrack as well. A lot of
Has
stuff
it, by
there.
God? Does it have a Gang of Four?
I don't know.
Cobra Kai
it's got, soundtrack. It's got Whitesnake, Here I Go Again on My Own and all that.
Oh, that's the... Mm. That is, well, that's what definitive, like, it's 2 a.m. and I'm knackered and then that song comes on and suddenly, I made up my mind.
I mean, don't, because I miss Nights Out quite a lot. And Oh, is this just on your own? If it's 2 a.m. and you're knackered, stick a bit of Whitesnake on.
At this point, yeah.
Just ready to go.
Me and my wall.
Yeah.
So, yes, it's, I'm trying to look for a website just to tell me all the bloody songs, but it's just.
That's okay.
Yeah, this is going nowhere. Oh, wait, we have. Nah, it's crap. Sorry.
There's also...
The internet hasn't evolved to give me a very easy website to give me all the bloody songs on one soundtrack. But Cobra Kai, I have heard many people talking about this. I should watch it, but I actually deactivated Netflix because I watched everything I wanted to watch.
Right.
Gave it a break. Me and Netflix are having some time out.
Fair. There is, I'll tell one, because there's lots of callbacks to the original Karate Kid. There is one good bit, which is where Johnny's sat there. He's obviously making his first student clean his new dojo that he's bought on some like strip mall. And yeah, so obviously he's cleaning the windows and the kid goes, Mr. Lawrence, is there any particular way you want me to clean these windows? And he goes, I don't give a crap. It's just so, like, it's very good. Very good.
Okay, that's nice. And those were the three picks for the Hall of Fame this week. They were Kevin Nash, ASMR, Mudkip. It's called Mudkip. It's way easier for my brain to remember it. thing that he did with some company. I probably made a lot of money out of it. Ross Tweddell's mighty pick of just NXT this week or just one specific bit?
No, the William Regal player.
The William Regal player bit. And Jack King's Cobra Kai. Just the first two seasons. I haven't seen the third one yet. Doesn't exist yet.
Yes.
But you know what does exist? The ability to vote for one of these fantastic picks by going to patreon.com/acultaholic.
This is This Week in the Wrestling. It's This Bloody Week in the Wrestling.
Ha! Ah. This Week in Wrestling. Before I do that, I do realise that I may be looking rude or whatever. It was my birthday this week.
Oh,
and
God!
I had many people...
Happy birthday for the other day, Matthew.
No, it's, no I wasn't aiming like that, but thank you very much, Jack.
I reacted like an anime character who sees a girl that he likes there. I was like, no!
Yeah. Falling on your head, nosebleed. I appreciate that, Jack. But the I had lots of nice people saying nice things about me. That makes it a nice change. But I just want to make a little shout out to Stephen Scodes, who we all know. It's one of the lovely, lovely fans we have here at Cultaholic. Many like him, but this one is mine. He made a little video of just highlights. I say highlights, it's just me talking, generally wearing shirts on the Cultaholic podcast over the years and how I've evolved from hairstyles to the size of my chin for some reason. From when we were doing them to at the very start, we're all huddled together like
with a dynamic, like the dynamic camera work.
Not the camera angle.
We look like three homeless dudes surrounded like one of those bins that's on fire. You know, the start. Hello. You know.
I felt bad for Pachi because he had to spend an hour just hunched over with the second camera.
Yeah.
God.
Whoa, dynamic camera shot. And I can't believe we did that. That and it wasn't a parody in any form or fashion. It was.
That's right. Cultaholic in your face. Oh.
Flying a drone over the ceiling of the room.
Hey, we're going to start off this week with a joke about a pedophile cut, Matthew. No, not on a fact. Well, we can't say that. No. Just say something else. Oh, but we can't think of another term for a sex offender on this podcast. We'll go nowhere. Oh, we'll just not talk about him, I guess.
Pachi can con the population of Dorset or wherever. That's allowed.
Right, thank you, Jack. I think we all say this at the same time.
That was very funny, though.
Matthew, we can't be like that. That's not a very good image to set. And then he's like, hey, I'm on Facebook groups.
It was very good, though. I did enjoy it. I enjoyed the picture, which had Mr. Pachini underneath it of him.
That's our boss. Okay, so casual reminder. Anyway,
I knew him before he was the majority shareholder. It's fine. It's all fine.
I didn't. My point was, thank you very much, Stephen, for making the effort of doing that. It was very refreshing, very flattering to see someone focus on me that much to make a little music video. So someone say, thank you very much, pal, and I hope you're all right. And for everybody else, thank you as well. It's not a competition, but if it was, Stephen won. SmackDown. We get a big carousel, what, of an opening promo with each eight-man tag.
Revolving, like, one person comes out and then another person interrupts them and might have been a better...
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry, a better simile, yeah.
Metaphor. Like the Macy's Day Parade they do in America at the bit where Goku nearly gets taken out by the winds every year. It's fantastic. New Day and Street Profits versus Zayn, Corbin, Roode and Ziggler. The good lads win and IC champion Sami Zayn takes the fall. Uh-oh, says here.
Doesn't bode well for him at Survivor Series. No,
Dory, we'll be coming to Survivor Series, you haven't forgotten.
I'm glad we do these in order now.
Yeah, right. Natalya complains to Adam Pearce about having to wrestle a Survivor Series qualifying match, but wins anyway, beating Tamina. The point was Tamina. Sorry, Ross. The rest of Team SmackDown join her in the ring. How are you feeling, mate?
The disgruntlement of this entire podcast is growing because I'd forgotten about that. That had been repressed as well, deep into my subconscious. But you brought it back, Matthew, screaming and kicking. How can Natalya beat Tamina? What sort of that about? Natalya's a joke.
Well, it's like Bret Hart beating Yokozuna. Technical, more intelligent, negating the power advantage. I'm trying to speak in kayfabe. It's not working. You don't look amused.
You can't compare Natalya to Bret. You can't do it.
Well, they're both hot.
I got told off, by the way, for saying that. Because I was saying, like, she did a sharpshooter Survivor Series. So I was like, ha, 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 a heart doing a sharpshooter Survivor Series and there's no bell before the tap out. Ha, 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 ha. That's so disrespectful, Ross. She's a night heart, not a heart. How dare you say that? Yeah. How dare you say that?
Who said that?
Upwards of two people.
Okay.
It was N9Heart at twitter.com. Yes, I mean, you are technically right, but you're not. It's not your fault that you think that, given that every time she came out in commentary, Natalya Neidhart, her uncle is Bret Hart. Also, Jim Neidhart is his dad. You know, every time. Even on Father's Day one year, when it was Money in the Bank, they went, Bret Hart's watching this. We don't know what the Anvil's doing. Roman and Drew signed the contract for their Survivor Series match. Roman tells Drew he's the number two champion of the company.
Ooh.
Ooh. Murphy beats Rollins clean. The boyhood dream has come true.
He's been trying for a while, so he's finally done it, you know?
Aye. Some would say he's very trying.
All it took was the... No, never mind. The sensual touch of a teenager, I was going to say.
Well, I'm glad you didn't say it. Christ.
What happened? What happened in this match? Where was the sensual touch of a teenager? What was
no,
that?
No, just since, say he's it found, again. Since he's found the love of... Of Ray's daughter.
I thought you meant Aaliyah got involved in the action. I was like, what the hell's going on here?
She literally boosted him into Rollins.
You can do it, like, buddy.
Like Undertaker's urn. It's like,
it's like when Bart can't go down the big hill and then Jessica Lovejoy kisses him and he can do anything and he struts home. That's what Murphy's win was like here.
Yeah. She was a kid and all. Asuka and Sasha Banks argue in the ring ahead of their match. Carmella ambushes Sasha and Asuka just watches. Ooh, intrigue. And then Daniel Bryan gets revenge on Jey Uso, beating him in the main event and probably establishing himself as Reigns' next challenger. A good lead into Survivor Series. Oh, that's next.
No.
Oh.
Miz wins a pre-show battle royal, last eliminate the Big Dom himself.
Weird elimination.
The only way of ending battle royals that we know is to have one dude kind of go out the ring and then sneakily come in. Ha ha ha, I was actually pretending to be eliminated. But no one cares about that. Chad Gable. God, did he look good for the first time in forever.
Changed his attire just to make them say, like, look, I look like Kurt Angle. I wrestle like Kurt Angle. Now I wear the same clothes as Kurt Angle. Make me Kurt Angle, will you? I'm like Kurt, honest. He was good, though. He was good. But yeah. I thought this battle royal was a bit symptomatic of the issue with the Raw versus SmackDown ting. Because everyone was in it for themselves, weren't they? Only The Miz had red on, Dolph had a blue hat on, nobody else gave a toss. And I thought that was a crying shame at this year's Survivor Series. An event where we didn't keep count, by the way. We didn't know who won on the night.
I think, Ross, though, with the type of people in that Battle Royal, I think those people were less focused on their alliances with the brands and more hoping that they'd still be employed by the time TLC came out. So... It was not a star-studded lineup. It was a battle royal. It was a thing. Speaking of things, the Raw men's team sweep. I beg your pardon. Go on. Put your hand up, lad.
I just want to dwell for a moment on Dolph's blue hat. Because that's made an appearance before at Survivor Series. Is it a running joke? Is it a backstage funny little in-joke between the lads? And then when he lost it, I think Otis put it on later on in the night. Or was that a different hat? The blue hat, the solitary SmackDown blue hat, has made an appearance before, and I want to know what Dolph's up to with that. Have you ever played on a night out Save the Queen?
I've done okay. Mr. President. Is that the same?
Might be. At uni, if I was on a bloody bar crawl with the boys, we'd play a game called Save the Queen where there'd be one penny, and you had to, if you had the penny, you had to put it in someone's drink and then they had to down it to save the queen from drowning, right? Very toxic masculinity, okay? And then that person had the penny in their possession, now they can put it in someone else's drink, right? It was a pre-COVID drinking game. Now, I wonder if the hat is the penny and they've got to wear it. No. Carry
or the,
on.
Or the queen dies.
I shouldn't have ground the podcast to a halt. I'm sorry. You can carry on, Matthew.
Just reapply the handbrake. Sorry, that's fantastic, Jack. But what was the did you ever play it? I love that you brought this up. We can spice it up.
Oh,
I realised that game that game that you brought up had nothing to do with the game I was thinking of. But go I don't know if there's a term for it. It's called like Get Down, Mr. President. But it was a thing going around when I would go out, go out nights out, when everybody would do that. And we had one person, and they put that the like the things on there like that, and everyone noticed somebody else doing it, so they'd all do it, and then they'd have some person as the president, and then they'd all three, two, one, and they grab him, get down, Mr. President, take him down.
I have never seen that before in my life.
That's good.
I want to know if people watching this have also done that, or it's just one thing my mates knew.
I like that. That's
again, we
one.
Do this in England. So it's not, get down, Prime Minister, who cares? But you know, get down, Mr. President! It's like, we're talking about FBI people.
We just had I didn't like to join in with this one though, because as a Sunderland fan, but because all the college bars in Durham are about a minute or two apart from each other, all the way down to the town centre, sometimes someone would shout Shearer, and then everyone had to run to the next bar doing that. Now I wasn't too, I'd jog behind without raising my hand, because I felt like I'd be betraying my dad if I did that.
Do you not go Peter Reed or
Peter Reed jogging slowly behind Maradona as he weaves through the England team?
Do you see that clip of him meeting Maradona all those years later?
I've seen the clip of Peter Reed. That was nice. He's quite a dignified old man. What did
he
say?
Around and says, I want to see your front because all I saw was the back 20 years ago. Good one. Good
seems
one,
like man. A nice man.
I like Peter Reed despite his allegiances.
Well, I like Bobby Robson.
We can they're the same.
Why don't we be friends?
How dare you?
Raw versus SmackDown 1986. Figure reading one hand by Robson the other. And then Kevin Keegan shows up to fall off his bicycle. the Street Profits. Oh no, sorry, I missed one. The Raw men's team sweep Team SmackDown with ease. Rollins gets himself eliminated on purpose. Why he didn't just let Sheamus pin him and had to take a kick, I don't know. Raw actually worked together as a team and celebrate in heartwarming fashion. AJ's delighted. There were some nice bits in, some spots like Jey Uso jumping on top of Keith Lee's shoulders so he could bop him. I didn't care about this match at all. Why would we? There was no reason to care about it. Any other thoughts apart from that?
Keith Lee looked good at the end.
Mm-hmm.
That's it, isn't it? Yeah. Keith Lee got a new theme, finally.
Oh, thank
it's
you,
a,
yes.
It's a that. Banger. I quite like it. It's not as good as the old one, but it's good all the same. So I honestly can't remember a thing that happened in this match apart from Rollins, for the greater good, sacrificing himself.
Otis and Uso ran wild for a bit when it was just them at the end. They fought really bravely, but lost anyway. That was sort of the story. And then Roman obviously was like, get out of this family. Get your brother, who did nothing wrong, and get out.
And Otis went, what are you talking about? I'm not part of this family.
No, I don't.
That's a scene they need to do, just some sort of scene where Roman's hosting a dinner and Otis rocks up and just eats everything. And then Roman's upset and Roman has to deal with it. That's something I want to see on SmackDown.
I like the idea of him going, look, I'm not saying you could be replaced, Jey Uso, but Otis is sat in your seat in the buffet. Like, what? Goes there and he's like, anyway.
You know what I was watching just before we came on here? It was Luther Reigns. Remember that one when he had the Thanksgiving dinner?
Oh, my God.
And he comes out supposed to be this big medicine heel and Taz is there stuffing his face and Taz just sort of goes,
Keeps munching.
Taz can see in the future and goes, this guy's going to be here in 6 months' time. It's awesome.
I've had those peas before. What did he say?
I've had peas. Give me some peas. Yeah. Give me some of that turkey. I remember the remixes people did back on You're the Man Now, Dog Dog. Okay, again, I aging myself by 50 years. If the Peter Reed reference, Kevin Keegan falling off his bicycle wasn't enough. Talk about You're the Man Now, Dog. Christ. Anyway, back to the reality of 2020. The Street Profits beat the New Day, and Kofi and Woods showed the younger team respect afterwards. I love this match. I very much enjoyed this. This was on another level compared to the rest of the card, as far as I was concerned, because it felt like a real proper pay-per-view match between the New Day, who everyone loves and establishes. They came out in their special Buy Gears of War 5, it's out now, costumes. And the commentary emphasized how the Street Profits are being compared to the New Day. Because it's not often they get, you know, charismatic, nice, cool black tag teams in WWE. So when it happens, fantastic. Who else are they going to compare to but the New Day? And so it actually felt like they had a proper issue, even when they were doing stuff like making fun of them or getting the red cups and throwing them. This felt like a big thing, and it delivered in the ring, and I loved it.
Bit of a passing of the torch as well, maybe.
Giving them the rub, like you should have done with Owen.
That is not what we get up to in this household.
Anyway, any thoughts, Jack?
Oh, yeah, I thought it was the best match of the night, probably. I know the main event divided opinion, but we'll get onto that. But no, I enjoyed this match a lot. That was very good. Ross?
Yep, very much the same. Angelo Dawkins looking very svelte. That guy's got remarkably better in shape than he was. As I'm sat here looking like this. but he was good. It was just a good match, wasn't it? Enjoyed the heelish. I forget who said it on the pitches video, but pitching for the New Day to be more heelish than they were. Was it Jack? There you go. Yeah, Kofi Kingston with the cup, murdering the cup. Only in professional wrestling would that be a thing. And that's why we like it, isn't it, lads?
Yeah.
Nothing but positivity here. Oh, wait. Sami Zayn tries to run away from his match with Lashley, but the Hurt Business don't let him. Lashley wins. So they're both diddlers. But in this match, Lashley heels, was the heels, good diddler.
Bad guys.
They were both the baddies. But Lashley was the good baddie. And Zayn was the bad baddie. Because he was like, oh, this country. And like, oh, he's anti-American. And that's worse than being...
Well, yeah, but because Bobby Lashley's the champion of the United States.
Oh, that was it, yeah. So Wells really invested in this match between two people who have no issues going against each other there. The only thing they reminded me of was the 2018 feud. Sami Zayn complained about getting vertigo. And I'm like, oh, yeah, they did feud. It was crap back then.
That bit was quite funny from Sami. But apart from that, not really a fan. And I didn't screw Owen, by the way, because he went for Sami Zayn. I can't be blamed for Owen losing if he picked Sami Zayn against Bobby Lashley. Come on.
Look, all I'm saying is the booking of Cultaholic could be better. Sasha Banks can't get Asuka to submit with the bank statement, but catch her in a roll-up for the win. This was better than most of the stuff on the card because they're establishing that Sasha Banks is not going to lose her title straight away like she has every other time she's had a title. So at least this makes sense and it's going to have some effect on the weekly storylines going on, unlike, you know, Sami Zayn versus Lashley, which is already forgotten about. What do you think, Ross?
Transitions was the name of the game in that match. Mm. Unbelievable scenes. Fluid. Liquid wrestling. It was just probably the best match so far this year, I would say. I remember the one on Raw that ended with the silly bollocks and then the one at SummerSlam, wasn't it? I think that this was the best one out of the three, I think. Maybe I'm all right with saying that.
No, I think the other one they had.
I think the SummerSlam one was
better. Yeah,
SummerSlam fair enough. I can't remember that far backwards.
Still good. Why is this thing keep on zooming in? Sorry. Any thoughts there, Jack?
Weirdly, I get accused of this anyway, but I actually totally agreed with what Meltzer said about it, I think, or Alvarez.
Who? Some of them.
I don't know. So they said that it was like very good match, but it was like they'd envisioned it being a better match. Some of the stuff they were doing, it was if they thought it was going to be a bit more, maybe they had less time to work with than they thought or something. There were some little things that didn't make sense quite to me, but I thought generally, as Ross said, very fluid, very good. Ooh.
Do you disagree, Matthew? Let's have a fight on the
podcast. No, I like that. No, he'll just beat me and retain his title. That's like poking fun at Jack every time I can get a chance to, like then. Oh, never mind that. Lana is the sole survivor of the women's title. Oh, Christ. Without really doing anything.
No, don't skip over it because it was bad. People want to hear us talk about it.
Some of these things I've forgotten about and I'm reading them. I'm like, oh, yeah.
I wrote those notes for you.
Without really doing anything, after Bianca Belair and Nia Jax both get counted out, most of the match to me was much ado about nothing. It's just like, Lana, you suck, boo. And then she stands in the corner going, meh. I'm like, wow, I can really get behind this babyface character. Like, and then the ending, Shayna Baszler gets Bianca Belair. She puts in a submission. I mean, she does it beautifully as well. It's like, oh, handspring. Nope, don't think so. Catches her. Awesome. Love Shayna when she's doing her stuff. And then Bianca, she gets the ropes, but no, she's actually out. She's completely out. So Shayna holds it on. She refuses to release it in 5 seconds. So she's DQ'd. That's crap.
Shayna's so Bianca Belair,
the submission magician.
Yeah. Oh. Is that real?
That's a nickname, isn't it? Submission magician, Shayna Baszler.
I will never call her that.
The submission magician?
The submission magician?
No.
Oh, I've not made this up.
Oh, it sounds like you have.
She's not a magician. Awful. Magicians are playful.
Not after that finish, no. She was beforehand.
I was going to say, anyway, not to get distracted. So she does that. Bianca Belair's... she's out. She's an ex-Bianca Belair, right? So then Nia comes along. She's like, I'm going to get you on the outside. And then Bianca, like, recovers straight away so they could do the count-out finish.
Well, she's Bianca Belair. She's strong.
Yeah, but, I mean, the entire point of getting put to sleep like that is you're out for a bit, not you get grabbed and, oh, I'm awake now.
I thought your issue was going to be that it made Shayna look stupid because she kept on the hold for no reason.
That too. I like Bianca Belair, but no one should be putting a... Sorry to take it back to 86, but no one should be putting a hold like that. Go out. I'm all right. Seconds later. I thought this match
It's adrenaline, Matthew. It's the adrenaline of the Thunderdome. Rush. Pulsing through her veins. That's what got her through.
Well, you needed coffee and 3 bags full of Monster Energy to get through this. I thought this was rubbish. This did nothing for anybody. No one came out of it looking good. And Lana sucks. She won. She looked weepy. She cried on Raw.
Poor Lana.
This was all terrible. I don't like anybody.
To be fair, when they did that bit at the start with the, you get on the steps, you rubbish little woman, and then she started crying, I thought, yeah, fair enough. Sympathetic babyface Lana. She's getting bullied. People get bullied in the real world. This is relatable stuff for people like me watching the wrestling. But then, surely the obvious story to tell here after the Build 2 Survivor Series is Lana going, hey, Nia and Shayna, you pair of dickheads, I can wrestle. I'm going to go in there and do some wrestling moves. And then that's how she earns the victory. But they didn't do that, and it was weird.
Well, we'll see what happened on Raw. There was a bit of a fallout.
Asuka ran away, didn't she?
Bravely.
Yeah, the role of Chad Gable will be played by Lana. Fantastic. Now that the role of Kurt Angle will be played by Chad Gable. They've got to mix it up, you see. Roman Reigns beats Drew McIntyre after interference from Jey Uso. He forgives Jey for losing in the Elimination Tag Match. For the first 10 minutes, I'm like, I'm bored of this. This is doing nothing for me. And it's kept on going and going to second gear, the third gear, the fourth gear. I'm like, oh, okay, I'm digging this. And then, you know, one of the Usos ran in and did his thing. I'm like, oh, good. Wow, Drew McIntyre getting protected in a loss. They can do it. Oh, lovely. Yeah, really enjoyed it. Don't think I'll rewatch it. It wasn't quite as good as New Day Street Profits, but yeah, really enjoyed it. Ross, what do you think?
You've said it all there, Matthew. I've got nothing else to add. That you've summed it up there wonderfully.
Oh, I love you too. Jack?
Matthew, even, I'll just echo what Ross has said, and you're a champion of men, and you've done really well with that summary of that match.
Oh. Oh, it's my birthday. It's been birthday week, right?
No, it's not because it was your birthday. No.
No, just said everything that was on my mind and on Jack's mind as well. So why say any more when you've stolen the show there, taken all of our thunder? More credit to you. All the best.
I'll move on then to the main event. A whole host of Undertaker's peers come out to celebrate his 30th anniversary. Vince McMahon gives a short speech, and then Taker comes out to actually properly retire.
Yeah.
Believe it when I see it. But they did what they could with what they had. It was like, we couldn't have Tracy Island from the Thunderbirds bought from Argos, so we had to make what we could with the toilet roll and the washing up liquid at home. They had everyone that they could come out and give their praises. The Godwins making their first televised appearance in, I couldn't even tell you when, maybe 98. And all these other people from the BSK, lovely memories, happy memories. Everyone wearing a suit and looking dapper, apart from Kane.
Gotta love Kane for that. Fantastic stuff. He shouldn't be in a suit for the farewell of his big brother. Would have been wrong, in my opinion.
Yeah, Corporate Kane's not The Undertaker's brother.
No, proper different man altogether.
I wish he'd been in his old gear, though. Not his new gear.
What you mean, like the mask? The first
like
one?
The full mask, yeah. Or like even when he started to get the chin out, I still wouldn't mind it if it was that sort of early 2000s one. But you know, it's still good, isn't it, to see Kane?
He did an old school like farewell speech.
I will miss you. I did enjoy how like everyone was getting in the ring and going like, oh, how you doing? It's been a while, shaking hands and whatnot. Kane just gets in and just walks to the other corner straight away. Keeping the kayfabe alive is our Kane. I love him. And wearing a mask as well, which he voted against or something earlier this year. So.
Oh, yeah, well done. No, I thought about that. And yeah, had some Tesla machines at the start, players' theme, and some people asked online, were like, what the hell was that? I'm like, oh, that's actually very impressive and cool. But they're like,
I thought it was cool as well, yeah.
Oh, what I thought it was electricity doing that.
Yeah.
I thought it was one of those, for Christmas one year, my dad, I think my mum got him like a nostalgic present. You remember those little things from the 80s, like the pen that makes the little song? Stylophone? It goes like, diddly, diddly, diddly. It's cra. I thought it was one of them. Like, diddly, 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 diddly. But it was actually electricity.
Mm.
Well, that makes a lot more sense than a stylophone.
It did just look like, when you just watching it, if like it just looked like the Tron, didn't it? Which was the issue, I think. People might not have got it.
Well,
it was just like the lightning was on the Tron, didn't it? Rather than actual physical lightning being in the, you know what I'm saying?
Mm. I know what you mean, because then they had the real Vince McMahon show up and you do sometimes go, is that the real Vince McMahon?
With his dyed eyebrows. Fantastic scenes. Got the Just for Men out and whapping in the eyebrows as well.
Paint at this point. He said WWF. What does he care? And said some nice things. It was what they could. But I was more focused on the fact that of all the people to show up at the 30th anniversary of The Undertaker, the Gobbledygooker showed up to win the 24/7 title on the pre-show. And then trip over to Zawa, which seemed to be a real thing because he couldn't see very well with the head, and then lose his foot.
And then stopped running.
And then just walked off.
And then he stopped running. and it's almost very similar to what we said on the Cultaholic pitches video. Isn't that great?
What did we say on the pitches video?
Yeah, it is similar.
Yeah, we said almost exactly that, except not at all. But I'm happy that the Gobbledygooker of all people showed up. Just pays respects to The Undertaker.
The Gulaki. I'm going to stop there. I was trying to make a pun with Drew Gulak's name and I failed.
Yeah, you don't want to be like WWE's social media people and tweet something unfortunate.
What did they tweet?
Shall I go for it? All right. Because Akira Tozawa won the 24/7 title,
uh-oh,
they held it there, and they said, I forgot what the word was, but they put the Gooker in something like that.
Oh, no.
And again, Gobbledygooker is a weird sounding name anyway. It does have incredibly unfortunate connotations, put out of context. And I'll move on quickly now.
Oh.
We love everybody of all types of people, but WWE doesn't. Monday Night Raw.
I'm going to throw something out there quickly, by the way.
Go ahead, please do.
Apparently Edge was backstage, but Edge didn't go out into the ring with the fellow legends who played a part in Undertaker's career. I thought that was a bit weird. What do you think they've got planned for Edge?
Maybe it's just to keep him a bit of a sneaky little secret until he comes back and attacks Orton or Fiend.
Oh, God.
Well, who else can he feud? Who else can he feud?
Aleister Black, someone like that.
Yeah,
he's on SmackDown, isn't he? Is Edge on Raw? Is Edge officially Raw?
Edge is a Raw superstar.
By the time WrestleMania rolls along, Aleister Black will be on AEW Dark, don't worry. Bless him. I don't care. I'm sick of seeing these old legends come up and have matches that have to be edited to look good before they even go live.
Oh, that was a good match. That was a good match. It was the greatest show.
It was an experience. It kind of got away with it, but that's it. It's like, that works. One time they do it, that's it.
Yeah. I think I'm biased because I find Edge quite likable. Seems like a nice dude.
Yeah, like me too, but 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Hey,
people need to move.
In the year 2020, he chases his kids around the house while doing the Michael PSA strut, singing the L3 Birds theme, Bad Street USA. You seen that video on Beth Phoenix's Instagram?
No.
That was quite funny. Just edging after the kids doing that. That was Danny. That was Danny Welbeck. That's not Michael PSA's. You know,
if he really wants to scare them, he should pretend to be Michael PSA's. So drunk on the plane ride from hell, he thinks Linda McMahon's a toilet.
Oh God!
Daniel's I've never heard that. He got up and he was taking his lines down, and he go to the toilet. And then, like, I think X Pac just went to grab him. He's like, no, don't urinate on Linda.
Danny Welbeck or Daniel Sturridge?
Sturridge is that one.
What's Welbeck's one?
That one.
Oh, I thought it was Drogba. Well, you know, similar. Celebration.
We should start a football podcast.
I do
miss speaking about football on YouTube.
But what will we bring to the table that other football podcasts aren't doing?
That doesn't matter.
Wrestling.
If wrestling YouTube shows you anything, it's just doing the same thing with different people over and over again. We just should start it.
Right. Who would it be?
You think we'll subtly do it and we'll just be like predictions for TLC this week, and it'll be like, you know, maybe Undertaker ? A picture of a ladder, and then Messi.
See, I don't know if it would work, because from what I've heard Matthew's references, I'm guessing you stopped watching football around sort of the Tino Espria time.
Let's go with that, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I recognise the name, so yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know if it would work. And there's already a 90s football podcast out there.
No. If you've got an angle, dear viewer, just let us know if you want to pitch us an idea for a football podcast.
Give us the idea.
And we'll steal it and then we'll do it for you. Yeah, we'll provide you with the service that you provided for us.
We'll write your name down next to one of these dogs. Anyway, we would hate to talk about like these old things coming back. Yeah, it's hard to get the mix of like staying current. On a related note, are any of you guys watching the Mike Tyson, Roy Jones Jr. fight?
When they're not allowed to knock each other out.
What?
Yeah, it's going to be an exhibition. I just found this out by way, Toby. It's going to be exhibition rules, which I think they've said for a while, but now the promoters are worrying because they said, well, there's not going to be any official judges at ringside because it's an exhibition match. But lots of people have bet on it. Yeah. So now apparently the people who organise on the fight, now they're going, we'll have our own dudes, you know, say, all right, this dude won or whatever. Because if you can't bet on it, then why are people going to bloody watch it?
Yeah.
According to them. I can't wait to see it because I literally can't imagine what it's going to look like.
I'm not going to watch it because... when I've watched boxing highlights and stuff, Roy Jones is one of my favourite ones. He's brilliant. But, you know, I don't want to see him and Tyson slowly.
It's not going to be slow with Tyson. You've seen those clips of him in the gym?
No.
Ooh, it might not last very long, but he won't be slow.
That first round will be good.
Bloody hell, that first round will be good.
The first 2 minutes are going to be quite special. Then you're going to move on.
And then have a big lifter in the corner.
Anyway, back to modern wrestling. Monday Night Raw, where nothing happened with Adam Pearce. He was in the ring with the Men's Survivor Series team. He says their victory should be rewarded with a title shot, but can't decide who. The rest is all bicker, and then Strowman gives him the Zinedine Zidane.
I did.
Look, all these amazing references. Later, Pearce decides in a six-man tournament to decide the next number one contender. Wow. Why didn't they mention this beforehand and hype this up for Survivor Series, the pay-per-view? Just saying. Three singles matches with the Matthew, winners going to a triple threat next week. Wait a minute. Right, Orton is included as former champion.
Because it was relevant to what you were saying.
Go on then. All right then.
The tournament may have been a last minute thing because of a Strowman rumoured injury. That's why they didn't hype the tournament before.
No, he's been suspended, silly.
Carry on.
Go back to your FIFA.
Sorry.
Later, Pierce decided, and I said that, Orton is included as a former champion and Lashley is in for Strowman, who was sent home after his attack on Pierce. It's not mentioned here, but somewhere along the lines, Pierce got a bit flustered and called our champion Drew McInfart. And it trended on Twitter.
Yeah.
The point where Pierce had to say, I'm sorry, our champion is obviously not Drew McInfart. He's the champion of something else.
To be fair, this came after the Strowman headbutt, so I thought it was fine. It sold the Strowman headbutt more than anything else could have by labelling Drew McIntyre Drew McInfart.
That is true. And Riddle said, I really want to be the WWE Championship.
But he was just high.
Yeah.
That first part of Raw was actually soul-destroying, I thought. Like, I don't want to be too dramatic, but it was awful. It was terrible. Like, yeah, try and find the good part here and there. Riddle said to Sheamus, I wanted to call you Ginger Crotch or whatever, Flame Crotch or whatever it was, but that was already taken by somebody on the team. That was funny, I guess. But yeah, it was really painful and really pointless and really infuriated with the Strowman stuff. Because when I watched that, I thought about your piss taken of the whole Mandalorian situation, Matthew. Thinking, like, just imagine if a non-wrestling fan was watching this and just watching Strowman act like that. They'd flick it off straight away, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Was this when he got offended by...
Last but not least, yeah.
Oh.
What do you mean, last but not least?
I'm last and least. What does he want, like...
Yeah, if something happened to you, Braun, are you all right? Like, why are you acting like this?
What happened to the kind Braun who would help children win tag titles and everything?
Well, we don't see them around for some reason, do you?
He's eating Nicholas.
That's right. How's Nicholas?
Delicious.
My least favourite trope in WWE when it comes to the good guys, and this, you're right, I agree with what you're saying, Ross, this adds to it, is when a good guy in WWE will say something that we're all supposed to think is hilarious. How do you know it's hilarious? Everybody else will laugh like no one else, like an alien trying to blend in with humans. So fire crotch, and it cuts to Keith Lee going, tee hee, like what?
And it's even better when it's Michael Cole who is providing the laughter track, because if Michael Cole's laughing, it must be the funniest and coolest thing ever. Yeah. Triple H is at WrestleMania.
And they're playing like, oh, the Thunderdome fake chants are like, ha, ha, ha. Braun, you know. Strowman going, well, I never. You know,
it's like the Hypnotoad. All glory.
All laugh at Hypnotoad. Ha, ha. Yeah, and they do that nearly every week. There's one moment. And it's usually Riddle or someone who's, you know, they all just walk around like they've got half a brain.
They try and make all the faces like Spider-Man, don't they? Like comics, but like wisecracking and cheeky. But it doesn't work with everyone.
Yeah.
And when it's so scripted as well.
Yeah. And not funny.
Aye, well.
Fire crotch. Where we are. The Hurt Business take all from the... Sublime to the ridiculous. The Hurt Business take on New Day for the tag titles. It ends with a double count-out. Then the referee decides it's a Hurt Business count-out win. And then they go, what the hell are we doing? And then MVP goes, everyone shut up, I know what I'm doing. We should restart the match because you don't want to win like that. And they go, that's a great idea. And they carry on like nothing happened. What the bloody hell? First of all, though, looking back on it, and I'm sure you guys did because you do the same thing that I do, they were both out for the 10 count. The referees, it doesn't come up very often anymore, but the referees are apparently still told, yeah, reinforce the rules when you can. DQ people when you have to. And if they're not in the ring by the 10 count or don't kick out, then that's it. That's the finish. They were both out for the 10. So I don't think the referee did necessarily do anything wrong, but you definitely look very worried when you realize there's still a bit 10 or 15 minutes left of this match to fill up time. So
yeah.
I thought it was just Mike Rome saying the wrong thing, wasn't it, on the microphone? Because the referee in the John Cohn in the ring was holding up the Hurt Business arms as if they won. I think Mike Rome said the wrong thing, didn't he?
Yeah, the referee, but the guy saw what we saw. They were both out.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, it's a double count out. No.
But it's not what he sees, Matthew. It's what the referee sees. It's the referee's discretion, not Mike Rome's discretion. Who's Mike Rome?
Yeah, they should have had Matt Riddle come out and like start doing a stand-up set so we'll all be distracted. What do you think of this, Jack?
I mean... It's always funny, but I always sympathise with them because it must be panicky. On live TV, you've messed up the finish. You know what I mean? But I thought MVP did a good job. He improvised. He's got the experience, hasn't he? So I think it was in good hands. But obviously, apparently there's a new initiative to... They're really re-emphasising that the refs have to, as you say... Are you all right?
I'm sorry, this bloody webcam does me nothing every week. It's just it decides to zoom in and out on the most random things.
Oh.
So I'm just trying to get into focus by focusing it.
Fair. Sorry, quite, continue, Jack. Quite sexy, the blur it is, to be honest with you, Matthew.
I'll leave as it is then. But you know what, I'll get Homer Simpson zoomed in because it likes that. Carry on, Jack.
Yeah, I just thought MVP did well. And we might see more of this in the future because apparently there's been a renewed initiative according to... I want to say PW Insider, but I'm not sure.
I've got to say as well, during this match, I think it's Alvarez who hypes up the unwritten rule where in WWE tag team matches, if the non-legal man attacks the legal man, that is a DQ and not just like shenanigans. They mentioned it on commentary for the first time, as far as I can remember, so it's actually a proper thing. And oh. Alvarez was right all along.
Do you get one strike and then you can't do it anymore?
That's to break up a pinfall or submission.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
It used to be, so it used that, to be yeah. that you got like three of them, and then if you did another one, that you get disqualified. That's the thing they tried doing in 95, I want to say, okay. and everyone just forgot about it and moved on.
Oh.
Kind of makes sense, but anyway, wrestling rules. The important thing is it got sorted out, New Day retained. It would have been good if it hadn't been for that. And then Riddle beat Sheamus in the first match in the One Contender Tournament. And these two beat the snot out of one another.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's fantastic.
Yeah. Keith Lee then...
Oh, it was fantastic.
Oh, it was fantastic. Yeah. Big man, slapping meat.
I'm sorry to talk over your fantastic camp lines there, Ross. Why don't you say it again for the listeners?
Not camp, just very, very manly, Matthew. Just two big men slapping meat. It's what we all want to see, all us manly men.
Oh. Woof, woof, meat, meat. Keith Lee beat Lashley via DQ in the second one after MVP interfered. And then
also
Keith
a great one. Also yeah, a great one. More yeah. men slapping meat.
And in the Firefly Funhouse, Bray introduces a new puppet called Friendship Frog. Alexa kills him to demonstrate why what she's going to do to Nikki Cross. She kills the frog, not Bray.
I needed to clarify.
Thank you for clarifying. These segments are definitely a thing every week.
We learned that they're not friends, though. So are they boyfriend and girlfriend, Bray Wyatt and Alexa Bliss? That's what I want to know. Because they were saying friends are evil, friends are bad, friends are this, friends are that. So if they can't be friends, what does that mean they are? Huh? What do you think they are, Matthew? They're not related.
No. Unless she is Sister Abigail, like it's teased on Twitter every bloody week. I don't know what's going on with this, but I am still interested in seeing what goes on with these little segments, even if it's a complete twaddle.
Oh, you know who'd be good is Sister Abigail.
What?
Well, Jazz, she's back out of retirement now. After retiring for about 2 weeks, she's now wrestling in Impact. She could be a good Sister Abigail. Remember when she shaved her head? She looked evil. It's cool.
Wait, bring Jazz I know back. Who could be Sister Abigail. You're right, you've nailed it, Jack.
Go on.
The Impact connection. The person who replaced a the kid, the person who replaced the answer to the Raw GM storyline. Of course, the way to get this is by having Hornswoggle become Sister Abigail.
That's what I was saying, yeah.
Deal with that right. little problem. Later, Bliss breaks down crying mid-match with Nikki. They hug, but Alexa hits Sister Abigail for the win. The mind games. Clever like wrestler, point ahead. Yeah, it's interesting stuff. Lana gets a title shot against Asuka, but the match is a no contest after Shayna and I get involved from the announce table. They try to slam Asuka through it, but Lana saves the day. This leads to a tag match between the four, which Asuka and Lana win after Asuka rolls up Shayna, and then they bravely run away.
Yes.
Wow.
I never want to see Asuka run away.
No.
Never. Never, ever.
So we remember a few weeks ago, every Raw has started off with them going, look at the lineup, and they've got like Randy Orton versus AJ Styles, and like, oh, a WrestleMania caliber main event. They've done that for every Raw since the announcement of Survivor Series. They had Asuka versus Nia Jax announced, and they said that was a WrestleMania main event.
Yeah, you know.
AJ Styles beats Randy Orton in the final number one contender semi-final after distraction from The Fiend, and I thought this is really well done until I checked Ross's Twitter feed, and he showed a little clip of The Fiend appearing and going, Bigaboo, and then they do the thing in the ring, and then suddenly Randy Orton's on the apron, and he goes, ah, Bigaboo again! And it showed Bray Wyatt getting caught on camera, getting in position.
Yeah, I made Richard's life a nightmare on Tuesday because I'd done the video, shot the video. He uploaded the video to YouTube. I reviewed it and I was making the pictures for the thumbnail, whatever I was doing. And I just saw it in the background. I was like, Richard, I've missed a massive one. Can you get back in the studio? And he had to re-edit the video and re-upload the video. And I just made his day twice as long. But I got some hate for sharing that on Twitter.
Mm.
Good.
And also a lot of people saying, well, what did you expect? Do you actually think he teleports? Oh, Twitter.
Tell him yes.
I don't know. I felt like replying, but I could not be asked. So yeah, but it is. I don't know what to say about it. It was just funny the way he was just like sort of rolling over the barricade.
They're usually really good about them, but I guess when you're cutting every 5 seconds, you're going to catch them eventually.
That was the thing. Someone replied, like, the one time Kevin Dunn doesn't cut like 25 times in a second and they catch that in the background shot. Unfortunate, but hey-ho.
You know what? You know when Undertaker used to make someone disappear? All the druids would come around and make someone disappear. When I learned that the person was just putting a druid costume on and leaving with the crowd of druids, I was like, this is insane. That's one of my favourite little tricks. Favourite little smoke and mirrors. That's brilliant, that. Love it.
I love when it was, how did they get that guy under the ring and no one noticed? And they go, oh, simple. He's been in there for 3.5 hours. Yeah. Like, oh, all right.
Hornswoggle said he's propping up all over on this podcast.
I'm right.
He used to take a PSP down there and then fell asleep one night.
Because he's a heavy drinker. So he just fell asleep and then Finley heard, it's like beating this dude. Like, wow, I wish my son could be here. He's in the ring.
I thought it was an Undertaker.
Yeah, there's one with Undertaker as well. He missed a cue for something. Yeah. Who was it with a bucket under there? Told the story about being under there with a bucket.
It's not the Kurt Hennig one, is it?
I've got no idea. Someone was under there.
The infamous one was, all right, the Kurt Hennig story that I've been told, a bunch of people told on different podcasts and interviews, was he was supposed to be under the ring with the Ultimate Warrior. So it was a 98 WCW. And Hennig loved his ribs. So apparently backstage at catering, he was eating every greasy, like, just chocolate, beef, and whatever. Some pasta. And everything he could, and just so he could just fart. Like, just have all the gas come out of him to annoy Warrior. It's like, you know. The story is that he ate so much bad food and drank so much booze, that he was like, I need to go. It's like, don't you dare, Henning, I'll kill you. Oh, I'm sorry. And he had to take a crap, a bucket in the ring. And I think, and then actually Henning was like, it's all right, I didn't spill it. Oh no, the bucket fell down. Oh no! That's a story, but then the punchline is, like, afterwards, Henning's going up to, like, some of the Nitro girls afterwards, it's like, hey, you know, you ever been with someone perfect? And they're like, we heard what you did in the ring, and that's disgusting. Get away from us. AEW Dynamite. Yes, we're back after that break.
We all needed wheeze.
And you would have seen and heard it if you had picture in picture.
Restaurant quality, as JR says every time.
Hanman Page beats Long John Silver. Arr. Afterwards, the Dark Order say they are here for Hangman and they knows where to find him.
Interesting.
Very interesting.
He's going to join the Dark Order.
I reckon he's the one who attacked Moxley.
Me too.
That would make sense,
wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Will Hobbs is now named... I can't believe you typed this. After the Crown... I'm reading what is in front of me. Will Hobbs is now named after the crown jewel of Newcastle's gay scene. Powerhouse.
Right. The biggest gay club in Newcastle is called Powerhouse. Everyone knows that from this town. And that's
everyone knows it. The five people that know it from this podcast.
And that's what Will Hobbs is named after now.
I used to go drinking in Powerhouse.
I've been a Powerhouse.
Great night out in Powerhouse.
I personally don't like the remixes. All of the songs are like... Doof, 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 doof. But the light-up dance floor, fantastic.
Mesmerising.
Expensive.
Dazzling.
These are just what some of the critics are saying about Powerhouse. Taz gets on the mic afterwards. By cutting a worked shoot promo. We all love those. We don't, but I love them when Taz does them. Taz's mic keeps getting cut off, but he refuses to leave until Cody arrives. Cody questions why Taz's son is training with him rather than his father, if FTW so good. And Taz slaps on the old Kataja Hajime and leaves before he gets his head kicked in. The guns chase Taz away, and he lives with his son.
He lives with his son?
No, it's how I say it.
Oh, right.
He leaves with his son, who has suddenly appeared.
His son was just there, and his son's called Hook.
What a great name.
Whoa.
It reminds me of Hook, the film.
Yes.
Yes.
Terrifying. It stayed with me forever where they put the gadgie.
Oh, no,
and when they put him in the treasure chest thing, they put the scorpion's going after him.
Who amongst you doubted me? Who was it? Terrible. Who did not full faith?
No. That's a really grim part of the film, yeah.
Oh, it was you.
But it's a good name for a wrestler, especially Taz's son.
Yeah.
Yeah. Talk about how great Hook was.
Do you want to? Do you just cite off the rest and just speak about Hook?
Because I watched it as a kid loads and loved it, but it's one of these films where you look back and read reviews and people are like, oh, I wasn't one of Spielberg's best. He was going through a messy divorce. I'm like, shut up. I don't know what you're talking about.
Rufio.
Rufio is the... Yeah. Well, he was in the news recently, wasn't he, for something?
Oh, no.
Anything I can't remember what it was. Just make had another failed takeover. Newcastle was led by Rufio. He was in the news for something. I can't remember what it was. No,
he too disagrees with Maradona's reputation as one of the greatest of all
time. There was a wrestler at North a couple of times who was just Rufio.
That's right, yes.
What?
His name was Rufio.
How can that be allowed? Sting stole a character, didn't he?
I was going to say, wait a minute.
Yeah, fair enough.
Until the real Rufio gets enough money to afford a copyright lawyer, I think he's all right.
Yeah.
Rufy. Oh.
Okay.
Nothing. All right. Well, and that is the end of the Hook discussion. See you later for the 90s wrestling football
podcast.
Channing
Rufies is a bit...
Oh, shut up. Yeah. We get a couple of tag matches next. TH2 beat Top Flight and do a beatdown afterwards, but the Bucks chase them off. They go, no, hang on. Only we can beat up the younger flippy tag teams. And then next, Jericho and Hager beat SCU and do a beatdown. But Scorpio Sky chases them off, one man with a chair.
So, first of all, Scorpio Sky is now Austin because everybody ran. And also, a lot of heel beatdowns this week. I'm going to say too many heel. Every time a heel wins a match, they do a beatdown.
You're not wrong, mate. Kazarian Dex, MVP... in the melee.
Oh, MJF.
God, he's everywhere this week, isn't he? He went, no, we should restart this match. And he went, no.
Sorry, he hit MJF because MJF cost them the match.
Yeah. Setting up Jericho versus Kazarian for the next week. And this was, bizarrely, the first time Jericho and Christopher Daniels had wrestled each other, despite the fact they're both 50 and have been everywhere.
Yeah. Crazy.
And Daniels is ageless at this point because he still moves around like it's PWG circa 2005. So, yeah, love seeing it.
And Kazarian, I thought, looked really heroic in this match. I've got very serious there.
It's the Tintin haircut.
Is it?
It's having knock-on effects to his wrestling matches. He is the hero we all need, like Tintin.
I thought there's a bit where Ortiz got on the apron. Tintin.
It is Tintin who's got the big fridge in the air.
You're right, but wow.
I don't know if his is very Tintin. But there's a bit. I'm just imagining Kazarian with a little white dog just running about. There's a bit where Ortiz gets on the apron to try and interfere, and Kazarian just like, I'm not having this, and decks him, and then vaults over and kind of misses him. But it's like really ragged and wild, and he gets up and just starts swinging at members of the Inner Circle. I was like, bloody hell, go on, Frankie. I'm well behind him. I hope he beats Jericho next week. The bastard.
And MJF's like, blistering barnacles. God. After Moxley was attacked last week, we get the contract signing, another go. Oh, here we go. So Omega, earlier in the show, said this is a promo where he's playing an over-the-top version of himself, which... remarkably looks very similar to his normal version, and says,
you hate Kenny Omega.
Like Jack, I just like making fun of him. It's like, oh, what a great match, and he does something bad. I'm like, ah, you suck. And he says about Moxie, he goes, oh, I saw a thing last week, you're talking about your dad, just saying, I think my dad could beat up your dad.
There's no way.
And
there's no way Moxley's dad is softer than Omega's dad.
Yeah.
No chance.
As a result of this, when Omega's doing his over-the-top entrance with the... sweeping up ladies and that, and he's doing, as people point out on Twitter, the bottom credits. You know, thank you for ever sent me that. Moxie attacks him and pushes him through the bit of paper, beats him up, and goes, "All right, mate, this isn't a joke. This is one of your games. This isn't BTE. This is one of your silly entrances. This is real. I'm gonna kill you. Sign the contract." And yeah, I am pro Moxley.
I thought it was great. I'm pro Omega for the ongoing storyline, but the bit, I think in the notes I wrote something like Moxley hits him with the move and then furiously shills the next week's show or something like that, because he got the mic all like fired up and just started coming out with like, I liked it, but he was like, win, lose, or draw. You come in the king, you best not miss. I don't take no prisoners. I was like, all the cliches would be. And then he was like, on December 2nd. And I was like, whoa, this is just a very intense advert. It was brilliant. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, it was great. Like, December 2nd, patreon.com/cultaholic. Mailbag at cultaholic.com. Loved it. And Hikaru Shida beats Anna Jay to retain her AEW title, despite Jane being passed weapons by Tay Conti and John Silver. Arr. Abaddon comes out afterwards and scares the bejesus out of Shida. She does. And then she licks the belt, which seems like a very, very bad idea to do at any time. Wow. Forgot to speak English there at the end. I'm very sorry.
It's just so disgusting you forgot how to talk.
Yeah, I had that mental image in my head and I forgot how to speak English. They misspelled Hikaru's name. Her new name is Hiraku.
Oh, really?
Nameplate. Yes, they did. Because they care so much about the women's division here in AEW, they should just let the NWA take it over and be done with it.
I wanted Anna Jay to win.
Yes.
I would agree. There was a little, I don't know if you noticed, either of you, but before the match began, she looked to John Silver on the ramp, and they're a wonderful little family, the Dark Order, because he gave her a little encouraging, like, go on, you can do this, you know? And I was like, they're the faces, really. I don't like Shida.
They need to do more, because I keep seeing how popular, because I don't watch BTE, but apparently the Dark Order do a lot of funny things on BTE, but they never do them on Dynamite, do they?
They're starting to creep in.
Need to do it more. I like what you did there.
I don't know what I did.
Creep? They are creepers. Remember that from back then?
He's a wrestler, so he's probably a creep. Yeah, Karen was.
I was just going to say, they need to start doing more of these like segments on either Dark or Dynamite.
Yeah.
Maybe take the place of Britt Baker's.
When he shouted Johnny Hungy, that was part of it.
Yeah.
I think. I don't really watch BT much either, but yeah.
Yeah, they need to make AEW Dark a 3-hour weekly show with 15 matches and some skits and whatever. The Butcher and the Blade beat Pac and Phoenix after interference from Eddie Kingston. Oh. I mean, look, I'm happy with Pac being in the main event, The Butcher and the Blade joining him, and the Luchadors as well. But Eddie Kingston commentating as well? Oh, chef's kiss. Eddie DDT's Pac on a chair a couple of times, but Lance Archer saves the day. Everybody dies. That's my phone going off. I'm very sorry. And also, Eddie Kingston does a promo where he goes, what's he go? Pac, whatever your name is.
Yes.
Poop, he said poop. At one point, didn't he?
Yeah.
Oh. I'll tell you what I liked about this, though.
Sorry.
I like, because when I initially saw Lance Archer come out, I was like, what the hell is he coming out to save them for? But then the commentators hyped up an altercation him and Kingston had a while ago. And I like how in this universe, like literally everybody like intertwines with everybody and everyone's got an issue with everybody in this like separate universe that is AEW. And I thought that was ramped up a big time this week, and I quite enjoy it because it's compelling viewing.
Can you remember what it was? Because I couldn't remember when I was doing it. Oh, right.
It was the
just taking the commentator's word for it.
Oh, wasn't it the Casino Battle Royal? Did Kingston eliminate Archer?
Did he? Is that what it is?
But they then struck a deal after that.
Nah.
And then I think
deals could be broken.
Something happened after Archer and Moxley. Do you remember Archer had a title match against Moxley? I think it was just on a Dynamite. Moxley won by rolling him up. And then something happened after. I think Phoenix might have attacked Archer. I can't remember. But something happened. Oh, excuse me.
Whatever it was, Eddie Kingston was in the right.
Okay.
Candice LeRae on NXT took on Ember Moon with heels Dakota Kai, Indy Hartwell, and Raquel Gonzalez surrounding the ring. Ooh. Indy takes Ember's finisher for Candice, who picks up the win. The baddies beat Ember down, but here comes Toni Storm for the save. Oh, instead she pulls a powerhouse and turns on Ember and joins Candice's awful team of bloody villains.
We can't call a heel turn pulling a powerhouse.
Pulling a powerhouse. A pint of powerhouse for the lads. What did you think of this? We won't call it that. That's very silly. What do you think of this diddler turn?
She did say there was going to be a new Toni Storm, didn't she?
Like the new Razor Ramon?
Yeah, that was it, yeah.
Oh.
I don't know what else to say. Yeah? It was a fine match. And then it was a heel turn, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, we now know. So Indy Hartwell isn't really injured, right? Because we saw her in a neck brace later, but I'm guessing they were just freeing up room for Toni to join the team. Oh?
I guess you're going to speak about it later, but who's the new Scream mask?
Oh, yeah.
Person?
I didn't put it in the notes, but yeah, there's a new Scream.
In the back of the car?
You know what? I think it might be. I'm sorry to unveil this. David Arquette.
Could be Ross's pal.
who is appearing on some show that we do here at Cultaholic.
It's out.
It's out now.
It's out now, is it? David Arquette is in Cultaholic. That's what we're telling each other. That's amazing, that. He was in Scream.
I watched it. What a lovely man.
Wow. He was a very nice man.
Lovely guy.
Friend for life.
They talk about
he wasn't.
Oh, sorry.
He was a nice man. Yeah, I probably my favourite Straight to Hell so far, I think. It was really nice.
No offence taken. It's all right.
Sorry, Dad, both of you. Yeah.
No. Mine was crap. It's fine.
To be fair, yours was early on, so it was crap, because I was awful at Straight to Hell's at the start.
But that's how you get better at something, Ross, is being crap at something and then getting better at
doing it more again, yeah.
Yeah.
And being blind drunk before you start shooting. Not really.
That's preposterous, Ross. That's preposterous. It was the night before we were blind drunk. Still recovering the next day. Timothy Thatcher loses to Kushida. Oh, I already hate NXT. Loses to Kushida after being put off by the watching Ciampa. This sets up Kushida and Ciampa versus Thatcher and Maffew next week.
I'm guessing so anyway, logically.
Maffew?
You.
Okay, good. That's what I thought you meant.
I was banking on you being annoyed by Thatcher losing for that.
I was.
And you were. So, yes. Good.
Yay. I'm booked for NXT. And I'll still not watch it. How was it, Jack?
Oh, it was a good match because they match up really well with each other because they can both do the technicals. But Thatcher's not looking great because he's losing and he's scared of Ciampa and he's meant to be Timothy Thatcher. Come on.
Yes.
I enjoyed how quickly he tapped out, though. Made it feel more real.
I'm in imminent danger, yeah.
That's what we said when he tapped out.
I am in imminent danger.
Maybe he's the referee from Raw and he wanted to make sure. No, I'm genuinely tapping out. This is the end of the match. We get a special NXT edition of the Kevin Owens Show. Oh, you talked about this. Which descended into an argument between Leon Ruff, Johnny Gargano, and Damian Priest. Regal shows up to book a triple threat at War Games. Sorry, I didn't say that right. Ross, what was the name of the show?
I don't want to shout. This microphone's very temperamental. War Games.
That'll do. For the North American title. Yeah. Jack, Ross has already spoken about it. What did you think of the segment?
I just love Regal. But Ross is right. I agree with him that Owens was a bit... It was a bit weird. It was like trying to be too meta and jam all of these funny references in. He was trying to be Deadpool, Matthew Owens was. But Regal... I mean, nothing against Owens. I still find him entertaining, but... Didn't quite work for me, but Regal saved the day.
Is Owens your Kenny Omega?
No. I really like Owens. Who is my Kenny Omega? I don't know. I'll get back to you. No, I'm a big fan
of
Owens.
This last week, didn't we? Yeah, yours is Sting.
Oh, Sting. It's mine is Sting.
Oh, I'm very happy, by the way, when I said all that stuff. I've had nothing but people saying, yes, Matthew, I also agree with you to help a pair of them. I went, oh, great. That's not what I said, but I appreciate it.
Someone tweeted me with a video of was it John? Tom's Photoshop friend, or was it someone else? Someone tweeted me with they've agreed that with me that Sting the musician looks like Lex Luger. And they tweeted me a little skit they'd made years ago where he's like, hello, my name's Sting, not the wrestler, the musician. But I look like this one or something like that. It's really weird. It's funny.
That was either
That was John.
John.
Was it John?
Yeah, it was
John.
Photoshop John.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Right. Yeah, she's from the area, so he could do a passable Geordie.
Yeah. He's a Gateshead man, I think. Or at least he lives around there.
All right, a possible Gateshead then. Cameron Grimes beats Jake Atlas, but Dexter Lumis shows up and challenges him into a strap match for War Games.
We're seeing a lot of strap matches, aren't we? Or is it just me?
It's Cody.
More than
Edmund,
normal.
Yeah.
Cody. Oh,
it was a Bull Row.
There's another promotion, isn't there? I keep forgetting.
Yes.
But no, we had Bray and Brian, didn't we? That was a fairly recent one. I'm sure there's one more in there somewhere. But yeah, can't wait.
Did Moxley have one?
If he did, I can't remember it. So it must
it all blurs into one, doesn't it? It's hard to keep up with this bollocks.
I've never seen a strap match and maybe go, oh, get in, strap match, my favourite. It's like the pineapple flavour of match types. Rhea Ripley cuts a promo denying that she's leaving NXT. That's not what our news says. Anyway, she's beaten down by Candice LeRae and her evil posse, who apparently have also beaten up Io Shirai off camera.
Yeah, they bring her out. They do the thing to explain why she wouldn't run out and save her. They've already got her and they've beaten her up. Yeah.
Oh, it's a good reason.
Yeah.
Pete Dunne beats Kyle O'Reilly in the War Games Advantage ladder match with help from a mysterious hooded figure.
Who's that?
Is that not the Scream dude?
I think it might be... Noah, was it the same dude, Matt Ross?
I saw the... I don't know what order they appeared in the show, but I saw the shot where Johnny and Candice are driving away and with the different Scream guy, but I missed the actual Kyle versus Pete Dunne match.
It was a good match, but I don't like these matches because the heel always wins and you know they're going to win because it only makes sense if the heels have the advantage in War Games. We'll see next week, though, if the women's one's next week. But I think it might be Tyler Bate.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, no. Well, he's...
Oh, right, okay.
Oh, yeah, that was I.
What was wrong with that?
I was just running through the pros and cons of my mind and I. Could,
Oh, well, he's pals with him.
He is,
both, both English.
Facial hair.
But wait, I thought that.
Oh, he does
that. The people who are major risk at COVID with the very old and the very young. So is he should be keeping away from this?
The very young.
Oh, I didn't mention Zach Thingy, did we? Zach Thingy?
Zach Thingy.
Five-star wrestling legend, Zach Thingy.
Oh, the grizzled young veterans.
Oh, Gibson and Drake, yes.
No, Dingle.
Dingle.
Is there a lag?
No, I'm
doing. No, we just don't know what you're talking about. Dingle.
That was so funny. That didn't matter.
Like Emmerdale.
Yeah, I was just surprised the chat was like, oh, Zach Gibson, as if there's a lot of Zachs that you could have picked from.
Oh, and then Dingle. Yeah. Right.
What other Zachs do you know? That's a good point.
Sorry.
Sabre Jr.
Ryder.
Gowan.
Sabre Sr., I guess. One has to exist while the other.
Ladder met at Leeds Festival in 2013. Good guy. Bloody good guy, that Zach. Yeah.
We should do a Survivor Series team of just Zachs.
Yeah.
And I think that was all for NXT this week. Any other wrestling happened? No. Oh, AAA announced Triple Mania is happening in December after wondering if they're going to do it or not. God knows what they're going to have on the show, but it is definitely happening.
I bet you cannot wait.
I cannot wait. I'm more excited for that than I am TLC or Winter is Coming.
It was obviously terrible and that really benefited you. But then the next year, it was actually really good.
No, I am genuinely enjoying the lucha when it's really good. But it can be completely awful as well, which is perfect for me.
It's anyone's guess.
But when it's great, it is very good. So.
It could go either way. I'm excited too. But I think it comes during the holiday season, so I don't know if I'll see it.
I'll make time for it.
All right.
I'll whip out the phone during the Christmas dinner. Anyway, that was all of wrestling. Let's go to something else.
Let's have a rummage in our mail bags.
Let's have a little look in the mailbag.
Rummage.
Wagwan lads, thanks for your years of entertainment. Keep up the great work. For the mailbag, could you answer one of these, please? If you could create a wrestler, Frankenstein's monster style, where you pick the wrestler's head, arms, body, and legs, which wrestler's body part would you pick? For example, they've said mine would be Roman's head, Randy's arms, Brock's chest, and Bully Ray's legs. Okay. Also, if you have a five-a-side match choosing only cartoon characters, who would be on your team?
We don't have to answer that one.
Stay safe. Love you, bye. And I think that's formatting's ruined it here. Is there a name for that one?
It should have been.
All
is that on the next
together.
Page?
Wait a minute, I'll have to break them up.
Oh no, is it ran together?
But you put at the bottom, question two, and then that starts with a name, so I assume that's it. Yeah, I've had a look down. Yeah, that's from Zach from Preston. Oh, he was just about
Zach!
Zach!
Oh, what a chance. Nice to see you coming, Zach.
You could be the guy who turns powerhouse on the rest of the Zachs at the Survivor Series thing we're doing. So, if you could, Frankenstein's monster, a wrestler, okay.
What's the five things
head,
where it was?
Head, arms, body, and legs.
God.
Knees and toes. So, should we go around a circle? We'll start off with the head. A wrestler head.
Triple H for me.
And why is that, Ross?
Because he thinks more.
That's right. I will go with Albert/A-Train because on the SmackDown podcast me and Tom were watching, he took a tornado DDT from Matt Hardy, and Lola said he's all right. He's got an 8 3/8 size head, so he's DDT proof.
I'll go for. I was going to go for like a really good looking one to put butts in seats, you know. But who's like the best looking wrestler ever?
I think that's a question that should be the big question, won't we?
Yeah, let's not waste that one.
Let's not. Yeah. Right. Well,
who
then
is
I'll
the
just,
sexiest of all time?
I'll just go for The Rock. The Rock's head. There we go. Yeah. He's a movie star.
Yeah, there's worse heads. Arms. Oh, Scotty Steiner. Big Papa Pump.
John Silver.
Almost as big as Scott Steiner's. Yeah, it's a good one.
Pistons.
I'll go for Roman's. I'll go for Roman Reigns' arms.
Oh, that's
looks,
a good one.
Looks
yeah.
cool. I'm building a Samoan.
Yeah. All the Samoans merging together like some sort of Power Rangers thing. God,
yeah.
Body.
Torso, do we mean?
Yeah, I think so. I've got
Who's
Brock's
got
chest the here.
Strongest
so.
Core.
Oh, I've got Big E.
Oh.
That's a
oh.
thick one, that. Like, oh, 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 oh. That is a thick one.
Like a badly parked Volkswagen. Go on. So it's a Red Dwarf line. Go on, Ross.
I'll go for War Geordie Pack because one hell of a core on show there.
I'll go for Balor, but my guy's going to look ridiculous now because he's got The Rock's huge head and Roman's huge arms and then Balor's underwear model body. But, you know.
Yeah. like Donkey Kong. I'm going to go with, for legs, oh, there's only one that comes to mind, Mr. Tyler Bate. Is built like a rooster.
Stacey Keebler.
Oh, God.
Stride across the ring.
And she's got legs.
Dun, dun, dun.
And she knows how to use it. Never mind. Whoosh. Jack, what have you got?
I was doing the instrumental part of that song by those people. She's got legs. Dun, dun, dun. Legs, dun,
That's
dun,
what ZZ
dun.
Top do. They go, hey, do the bit. Dun, dun, dun.
It's just like a Blues Brothers. What's going on? Like a Blues Brothers version of it.
Yeah, they shout everyone. Everyone, what are you doing? Put your phones down. Yeah. Dun, dun, dun.
I'll go for Drew. Drew's got some big hammies on him, hasn't he?
That's a good one, aye.
Mm.
Aye, from lugging his dad's sword around.
And so now we need some sort of talented artist to put those things together in some sort of arty picture form, and then we'll show them on the podcast.
Oh, God.
Photoshop Lovely. John to put it together and go, I read, it's me. The mouth doing that like a Conan O'Brien. And then moving on, a five-a-side match choosing only cartoon characters.
Oh, I'll just pick five Tazzes. He was on every single football sticker in the 90s, wasn't he, for your car?
That's, yes. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Oh, am I doing it as well?
Yeah, oh, the man has said a question.
Okay, I'll do the little lad from The Incredibles on the wing. Dash, is it?
Uh-huh.
The fast one. Uh-huh. I'll go for Bugs Bunny. Why not? He's crafty in Space Jam, isn't he? Bit of a good sportsman. Oh, God. I hate this. I hate this question. I like the last one, Zach. Why did you just leave it?
Should we move on?
I'm stressing myself. No, I'll do it. Okay. And Samurai Jack, remember him? And then Cow and Chicken. There we go. Good mix of size, speed, aggression, damage control style aggression.
Yeah, I'll have the Hurricanes as doing all the footballing. That's a very old.
Who the hell cartoon. Are the Hurricanes?
What is
this? It was a cartoon about a fictional football team.
They were Did you make it up? Magnet and Steel?
Yes.
Okay.
Anyway, yeah, the Hurricanes and then the Inspector Gadget in goal because he could extend his thing and be better than Peter Shilton, all I'm saying.
I'm going to reset. You've intrigued me there with the Hurricanes.
The Hurricanes and the something. And like a lot of those early 90s cartoons, it's like, and they have to win the football match for charity. And then there's an evil dude who just wants to win the football and make lots of money because he's already rich and I don't know. Yeah, actually, that bit was true in real life, but...
I used to love the program. It was on CBBC, like early 2000s, or maybe just late 90s, when Michael Owen was in a poster on the wall, and he would come out the poster into real life.
Oh, I can't remember.
It had such an inspirational theme tune with some like French horn sounding thing.
Yes.
Lovely. What a show.
Can I change my answer to the animals from the Bedknobs and Broomsticks football scene underwater?
Oh,
or when they go, no,
nice.
Not underwater. Yeah, when they, yeah, that's a great football match, that.
Yeah. What's the name of the teams?
Jesus, look at the Hurricanes, man. Look at the state of these lads.
Yeah.
Summary.
That's it. The Hurricanes versus the Draguna, Makode, Takorum, Satisfy.
Substitutionary locomotion. The series focused on a fictional football team headed by the heiress of the team's legacy, Amanda Carey, and their coach, Jock Stone. Was he Scottish by any chance? During the series, the Hurricanes football team would either be battling a renegade football club, the Gorgons, managed by, if you're Greek, I do apologise, managed by Stavros Garkos.
What came first, the Gorgonites or whatever you've just said there? That's what I'm asking.
The Gorgons.
The Gorgons or the Gorgonites?
Emissary of the Gorgonites. For pitch supremacy, or they'd be having wild, unpredictable adventures off the field in exotic world touring locations. Would they? Matthew, that's class.
As you can see, this is why they've still got it. At least play in the indoor league or whatever, but yeah.
Oh, it's very good.
I remember because one of them was from a poor country and he played football with no shoes or socks.
Oh,
on.
No, Matthew, something terrible's happened.
It's not like the way we looked up Roald Dahl one time and realised it was a frigging anti-Semite. What's happened?
Well, it's just a list of opposing teams they face.
Go on.
Every one of them's a country stereotype.
Oh, please. I'm sorry, what year was this made? And then read them.
I don't... the year it was made was 93 to 97.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, dear.
The golden age for
racism. Here we go.
Racism.
The Garkos Gorgons. Greece. Shall I say the... I'll say the country first, then. The Egypt. The Cairo Pharaohs. Mm. It's not too offensive.
Yeah.
Brazil. The Rio de Janeiro Cariocas. I don't know what they are.
Okay.
Japan. Mm-hmm. The Tokyo Typhoons.
Oh, yeah, they love natural disasters in Japan, like...
Germany. Noodleheim and Bayern Munchausen. Spain, Real Azul and Pamplona. Canada, Elks. Just Elks. England, Standish Park Rangers FC. Dunno. Zambia, Zambia Zebras. Ireland, the Timberrainy Shamrocks. Scotland, the Inverfinnan Celtics. This team name is a blend of Celtic FC and Inverness. And in Italy, DC Milan, which is lazy. Very lazy.
DC
Milan. Yeah. Well, that was good. Bayern Munchausen was my favourite.
Yeah, Jesus. That was worth it for that. Anyway, moving on. Thank you, Zach from Preston. I hope you like the Hurricanes, because if not, that was a really bad answer.
I need to watch that.
Number two. Topi contrived Hello Alternative. Yay. In your expert opinions, what are some of the best or most ridiculous obvious lies from the world of professional wrestling? E.g., Shane McMahon being the best in the world. And it says here, he's not exactly Johnny Gargano. And then there's an asterisk. And it says, P.S., I don't actually rate Gargano, but I know Matthew has to read this. I'm happy to hear that there's at least one other person who shares my opinion on him. Other ones could include Jinder Mahal declaring he would face Randy Orton in a Punjabi prison match where the only rule is there are no rules, followed by him spending the next 10 minutes explaining the rules. Kind regards, John from Lockdown, Hampshire.
Thank you, John.
Oh, fantastic. We're from Lockdown, Newcastle.
Mm.
Also named for Hurricanes team. That's a good point. Best lies, almost obvious lies. I think I've said this more than often. More once, but I think it bears repeating every time it comes up, opportunity to say it. As a kid, I legitimately thought when Crash Holly came to the ring with the scales over his shoulders, that because he brought scales with him, when the announcer says weighing in it well over 400 pounds, that he must be well over 400 pounds.
Yeah.
And that he just had such thick muscles. This is the expert opinion of Matthew talking. Ross, do you have anything like that?
Mine's quite topical because it's to do with Taker, and I've just had a sudden realisation as we're all sat there celebrating his 30 years in the business. We're celebrating the career of a man who murdered his parents and also thought he murdered his baby brother, but his baby brother survived and had psychological scars as a result. But there we were, heralding the legendary career of double murderer, The Undertaker. Well, triple murder if you count Muhammad Hassan as well, I guess.
Yeah, that is true. And, AJ Styles, but he came back to life. No reason.
Yes, exactly, yeah.
Attempted murder, at least.
And he killed DDP's push in 01.
Oh, yeah, what do you like?
So, yeah. No lies there for the best pure striker in the business.
But the best part was he admits it live on Raw, didn't he? He's like, yes, I did it, didn't I? I bloody did it. I set the place on fire and killed them in that shoot promo thing, didn't he, on Raw? Mm. And nothing happened. So it must have been a lie.
Yeah, but then it got changed to he only thought he did and it was actually Kane. But there's all going on while Paul Bearer was having sex with their parents and then that was never mentioned again. That,
Paul Bearer having sex on the floor with Kane's mom to produce Kane. That's just everyone should know that happened.
Yeah. We heard it. You can't unhear it. Jack.
Mine is a recent one when Randy Orton lied to Bray Wyatt to gain his trust and then burned down his house and then beat him at WrestleMania for his belt. But it was pointless because Orton won the Rumble, gave the title shot up to prove to Wyatt that he could trust him, then turned on Wyatt, burned down his compound and beat him at WrestleMania anyway. Why did Orton... Why did he not just win the Rumble, which he did, and then beat him for the title at WrestleMania?
Because it's just more fun that way, isn't it?
Okay. I suppose they had a few months to kill until WrestleMania came around. Yeah.
Like how in 95, Flair is getting attacked by Arn Anderson and Brian Pillman. He's going, oh no, I need help. Only one man can help me. Sting, can you help me? Sting goes, excuse me? You what? No, Sting, really, I'm being attacked by these lads. Me and Arn Anderson, we're no longer friends. Oh, I could really do your help. You want me to team with you? Yeah, I know I turned on you all those times before, but like this time you could really, really get together. All right. I mean, I am Sting. Not that one, but the other one. And I'll team up with you. But I'm warning you, if you turn on me, I'm going to kill you. All right, Sting, me and you. Flair and Sting forever. Yay. Woo. Halloween Havoc 95 comes. Where's Flair? He's been delayed in traffic. Oh, Sting in a handicap match against Pillman and Anderson. Oh, here comes Flair wearing just his trousers. Woo, he ran here from the airport or whatever. Woohoo, here he is, hunt back to Flair. Here he comes, bounce off the ropes. Punches Sting, takes him down. And I love every year that I get to replay that because it's the best thing that happened to Halloween Havoc 95, one of the best things to happen in WWE of that time period. But it's also made even better. As they're doing that, Sting's been beaten down for about 15 minutes already, and then Flair turns on him, and he pauses for a few seconds, and he just gets up like, Flair! Like he has all this anger inside him that he can't sell. He's like, I'm going to get... Oh, you're dead. You're absolutely dead. And Flair's like, ha, 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 ha. Sorry.
No, that's good. That's a good lie as well. But Sting fell for like... That was Sting's whole thing, was falling for these tricks.
He should have done it every week. Sting would have Oh, okay, Flair. Sorry, question three. Hi, lads. Hope everyone is doing well, and it's great to see Ross back. I was just recently watching the Broken Skull sessions with The Undertaker. He speaks about Brock ending the streak and how he would have preferred to put Roman over. My question to you lot is, where would Roman Reigns be today if he was a heel at WrestleMania 30, and had beaten the streak. All the best. Oh, God, I'm sorry in advance. It's spelled C-I-A-N in County Galloway.
Kian.
Okay, thank you,
from,
Kian.
From Westlife.
Oh.
Sure. That's also Irish, yeah?
Yes. Well, I think he means... Sorry, I'm being thinking about the question rather than the name. That he would have retained against Brock and then lost to Reigns at... WrestleMania, whatever year it was that we went, 2017. 2014.
No, he means if, because Taker said in the press that he didn't think Brock
needed the win, so if he had to pick somebody to beat him instead of Brock at 30, he would have picked Roman.
I would disagree with that, because Lesnar had a lot of the allure taken off of him. He had this match, the amazing match with Cena the first time round, a never-ending feud with Triple H, which sucked all the life out of him. This was a big fat reset button that got pushed, and then we got the Cena match at SummerSlam. So no, I disagree. I think it was the best thing to do at that point for Brock. If I realised that, that would have meant we had years of nothing but Brock on top. Maybe then, yeah, he shouldn't have won. But so my question, Ross, is what do you think about that?
About Roman?
Yeah.
I think Roman would have been buggered. Because I think the hatred was there already. Well, no, it wasn't there as bad as it got, but it was sort of getting towards that way, sort of to the midpoint of 2014. So I don't know why he would have gone, because the hatred would have just been so much, because he would have been the one to take away the streak. It's actually worked out quite all right, hasn't it, for Roman now, currently? Having waded the choppy waters that was, there's the fail. Well, no, it wasn't. Is it a failed babyface push for Roman Reigns? All those years of being booed by us blokes, I guess, and being cheered by the women and kids, that's what they all say, isn't it?
What a question. That's a difficult one.
I think he would have been buggered now if he beat the streak, though. Because where would he have gone?
Yeah.
Well, when he beat Undertaker at WrestleMania 2017, I was there the night after Raw, and again, the supposed good guy came out, got booed nonstop for 10 minutes, said, this is my yard, then left. And then maybe a week later, maybe it was 2 weeks later, he was like, hey, it's me, Roman Reigns. How are you guys doing? Tra-la-la-la-la. Like, what? No, what do you think? We forgot? Oh, it's ridiculous. So if they had Roman Reigns beat Undertaker and then be this Roman Reigns that he is today, 10 out of 10.
Oh,
absolutely.
Yeah. Oh. I agree with Ross, so I don't know what else to say, Kian. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I think I'm talking too much during these bits.
No, I think I am. I've thought that today about myself. Ross, you talk
It's
all
funny
the time.
You should say it, because I've thought that about myself as well. I've been and cutting people off too much, yeah.
Wow.
Maybe we should all just sit in silence for a period of reflection to readdress the balance.
Kutu thinking, but yeah, there we go.
There were like three comments I saw on last week's podcast saying that I'd become arrogant. It's like, what?
No, you've always been arrogant.
I was very offended because one of them gave a reason. Well, someone else put, why has Jack been arrogant? And they said, because he shoehorned in that story about being recognised. We should come after Ross had told the story about being recognised. I was livid. I was so angry when I saw it.
Yeah, but my story wasn't me going, oh, I've got recognised. Isn't that great? Like yours, clearly.
Mine wasn't saying that.
But, you know, yeah, there's a point. Ross was like, look, lads, people who see me in real life, I'm not like I am on YouTube. If you just be polite and move on, that's fantastic. Don't, like, you know, don't chase me to Morrison's.
Shout at me.
Shout at me, Morrison's, and force me to take the other exit so I have to avoid you. And he was just like, yeah. Oh,
No.
All the time, me,
a thousand new students here for to meet.
No, that was an ironic, bum.
But that's it. Look, there's nothing wrong with criticism, Jack. You can learn from that, and you can either keep on telling these stories, or you can go, you're right.
Well, there's nothing wrong with my story. Oh, dear me. Don't make me trick you with another fake story. What a time that was. The bag in the back of the car. Yeah, I nicked it, though. It wasn't mine.
That was your Flair Sting moment. So we're never going to trust you
again. He's off
again
bragging about his exploits in the podcast. Oh. Remember that great thing I did?
You're right, Ross.
So arrogant.
Oh, my God, you're right. It's very Pavlovian.
And also,
we're like, oh, something bad happened to Ross's house burned down. That reminds me when I won a lottery ticket when I was 17.
And also the other reason for my arrogance that was given was that I was being harsh to Owen.
Oh, yeah, that's
and
right,
if you watched last week and thought Owen was the baby face, to use that word, of the two of us, then I don't know what to tell you. Because he was being cocky.
I've thought about him having a go at those headphones quite a lot over the past week, and I still can't quite wrap your head around it. It's like, oh, they're quite uncomfortable.
Well, that's what I'm used to in the EWO.
Owen's used to work at PC World, didn't he? Do they do headphones? Maybe he's got better ones.
Probably overpriced ones, yeah.
Beats by Dre.
Oh, some sick beats. These are Bose. These are quite a well-respected brand, I think. I don't know. Yeah, I'm confused as well, Ross. I don't know what he meant. It was when he was like, it was when he started, when he went, immediately when he came in, 2 seconds later, is he behaving himself? Yeah. Is he behaving himself? Owen's never talked like that to me in his life. And then obviously I watched it back and realised that Pachiti had informed him to do this. So I looked like a tit.
That's not true. I did.
No, you told him to come in and I knew that.
Yeah.
But Pachiti told him earlier in a more overarching sense.
Oh, we both told
sense.
Him. Oh, I didn't know that.
Sort of. Pachiti told him just to be a heel when he was champion or to rub it in my face.
So your complaints about the booking, Matthew, they don't come to us. They go to Adam.
Thank you. Please direct your booking ideas for the Cultaholic Office. Anyway. Firstly, just want to apologise for my question last week. Oh, God, stopping the podcast dead in its tracks, like we've just done for the past few minutes. booking the Mania card seemed like a good idea in my head at the time. In practice, it flopped. Similarly to Vince and Brucey P coming up with Retribution.
Ooh.
Watching Matthew snooze his way through the question reminded me. Oh God! Wait! I'll wait for you to settle down for this. Watching Matthew snooze his way through the question reminded me of watching Joe Hendry and Gabriel Cage wrestling defiantly to a 30-minute draw at the Point in Sunderland and sending me to sleep.
Mate, we know both Joe Hendry and Gabriel Cage. You can't say
not after this. We won't.
Hey, I've not seen that match. That was defiant.
Yeah, I wasn't there either.
Yeah,
well, that was in Sunderland, so I didn't see it either. I saw the completely sold Sunderland? Out front row.
What's wrong with
when they aired it on YouTube. Another weird aspect of that show was seeing MJF, as he had been in Jacksonville a few weeks before having just signed to AEW. The thought of MJF being shown around Sunderland by the likes of Conor Renshaw was crackers to me. Not at all. This brings me to my question. Where is the weirdest place you have seen a wrestler, whether it be a strange addition to a card or just in public? If you can't think of any and need some content and discussion, are there any celebrities? Thanks from Dom Malaby. Dom, I'm very sorry for crapping on your question last week, lad. I'm very sorry. Sometimes we can get tired and sometimes we have Reese's Pieces. We can go, oh, okay, cool. Here's another list question. Here's another list one. And sometimes we're like, oh, Christ. So I'm very sorry, mate. On the plus side, though, that little bit there about Defiant was very funny. So you've redeemed yourself. You are our big Dom.
Oh.
So where is the weirdest place you've
already
seen
a wrestler? We've already got a kingdom, so...
No.
Okay.
I don't recognise him.
Oh, he's been... Actually,
after that
not...
question.
To be fair, kingdom was very much what culture? He didn't make the jump, did he?
I've not heard from kingdom.
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. I thought you were talking about Dominic Mysterio, the big
one. No, kingdom was a guy who used to phone into the live streams, and I don't know if Jack did it on his, but me and Pachiti definitely made him a recurring character on ours. We had Around the World with kingdom. He would... What was it? He would tell stories in different accents around the world.
It was Pachiti bullying someone.
Yeah, there was this 12-year-old kid. And Pachiti, yeah. Well, I would laugh along. I would snigger.
No. Kingdom enhanced the quality of those streams. You had all sorts of segments. You had On the Go with Justin.
On the Go with Justin Lowe. It was a guy who would take us around, I think, was it California? It was somewhere in America. And he would just take us around and live stream from his phone and just went through a car wash one week. It was fantastic. He took us to like a museum the next week. We went around a museum looking at things. I forget what the museum was about, but On the Go with Justin Lowe. That was my favourite segment.
Matthew, do you know how much Vichy and Ross had checked out of those live streams by the end? They used to have a segment
we would get
Tina,
wanted.
They used to have a segment called Tina Turner Nap Time. Can you please explain Tina Turner Nap Time?
We used to watch wrestling matches, and when we weren't feeling a particular wrestling match and thought it was a bit boring, we
all
would
the
then,
time.
All the time, yeah, we'd just declare Tina Turner nap time, which would just see us just sit back in the chair, grab a blanket, and just fall asleep on the live streams.
On what culture?
On a live stream. On a live stream. People paid a subscription fee, by the way. This was on What Culture Extra.
Oh, no, that's
which
terrible.
I was definitely against the very concept of Culture Extra, but that's besides the point. But
you know what, right? In a weird way, people did find it entertaining.
I used to get the worst hang... It used to be a Tuesday night. We used to stay up and watch SmackDown. It used to be on a Tuesday night, and then coming in on a Wednesday. Terrible. I used to have a bottle of, nearly a bottle of whiskey just during those live streams. Me and Adam got married on one of them by Kenny, who tricked her into an actual marriage, which we had to get annulled and all that stuff. So, what was the question?
20 minutes ago, somebody asked, what is the weirdest place you have seen a wrestler? whether it be a strange addition to a card or just in public. I've got one if you want to think of one.
Go on, you go, Matthew.
Because you're probably still thinking of bloody King Dom. this isn't my story. Do you remember Adam Rose, the Rosebud?
Mm-hmm.
One of my mates, I'm not going to say who, said he was in Phoenix. It's a really big superstore here in Newcastle. Goes on for miles and miles in the city centre. And he went to the toy section when WWE happened to be in town. And Adam Rose was there in the toy section of Phoenix next to the WWE action figures, right next to his WWE action figure. Almost looking like he was waiting to be recognised by someone. So my mate went up to him and went, "Excuse me, you Adam Rose?" And he did that. "Oh, who, me? Oh, yes, you know, all right." My mate's a kind of large person, and he was taller than Adam Rose. So he's like, "Can I take a photo?" And Adam Rose said, "Sure, but you have to, like, bend down or, like, get on your knees." Or he went, "Ha, ha, ha," thinking he's kidding because he's taller than him. And Adam Rose put his hand on his shoulder and pushed him down and took the photo of him. So Adam Rose looked taller than the fan.
That's a bit pathetic, that, isn't it?
Sounds on par for Adam Rose, though. So, and I like that story. What about you, Jack?
He gave us an out, didn't he, with a celebrity, if we couldn't think of a wrestler that we'd seen.
Yeah, any strange celebrity encounters?
Yeah. Now, this isn't so much a surprising place to see a celebrity, but it's got an element of mystery about it in that I don't actually know if it was the celebrity. It's Schrodinger's celebrity. So, that sounds craft, doesn't it? So, in Dallas, when we went over for Mania 32, we were walking back from somewhere, we'd been filming, and we were going back to the hotel to watch the Hall of Fame. Because we didn't go to the Hall of Fame live, we just watched it in the hotel. We might have been to get food. I don't know where we'd been, but we were on our way back to the hotel. Now, sorry, balls. In the middle of the Hall of Fame ceremony, for some reason, I left the hotel, maybe to go and get pizza from the pizza guy, and came back, right? Now, a limousine went past, reeking of marijuana, like absolutely stinking of weed, right? And I was like, whoa, bloody hell, that is strong. And I don't even know if the windows were open. Surely there must have been.
The sunroof was.
Were you there as well? Where had we been, Ross?
I can only picture walking from our hotel to where the Hall of Fame was, that stretch of road, and the limousine was on the right as we were walking down.
Right.
And the sunroof was open, and the smell of weed was honking.
Now, obviously the windows were all blacked out, but we get back to the hotel. Michael Hayes and the Freebirds are still singing bloody Bad Street USA for about 20 minutes. And it emerged that Snoop Dogg was late and they were filling time. I think that was Snoop Dogg in that limousine. What do you think, Matthew?
I think that was a nice story.
Oh.
I can't comment. I've never met the man.
No, me neither.
I was listening to Two Bears, One Cave, and Bert Kreischer inadvertently spills the beans that Cody Rhodes of AEW fame has partaken in a Snoop Dogg blunt.
No.
You can't say that on a stream.
The holier than thou. Cody Rhodes, potentially, just in the words of Bert Kreischer, dabbling in the Sweet Mary Jane.
What did he say about Cody? Did you talk about him generally?
I think he said he was a nice guy. I don't remember anything negative. I just remember him saying that and then going, oh, maybe I shouldn't have said that.
Cody's going to DM him.
The Hurricanes next week playing against the Florida Blunts. Florida. Oh, bungled that, Jesus. Ross, what's your story?
I saw Stephen Carr in Marks and Spencer's once. That's all I thought. It was the one in... bloody hell. Kingston Park, around that area, there was a Marks and Spencer's joined onto a PC World, and he was in there.
Famous ex-right back, ex-Newcastle and Tottenham?
Yeah, it was about 2007-ish sort of time. I was in the vicinity getting a PC, and my mum was getting us a PC, and we went to Marks and Sparks because we were feeling fancy that day. Now, we used to go to Marks and Sparks, and then there he was, buying all sorts of food. No, too scared.
Do you know what? I've seen a Newcastle... Surprisingly, I know it's Newcastle, but you remember CMD Young?
CMD Young, yes.
Was he the one who had a collapsed lung?
Yes.
Yeah, I saw him in Calzone, the hipster pizza place in Jesmond.
Did he have his collapsed lung on the table?
I think it was pizza, but I don't know. I just forgot. I just forgot about him completely. He had a bad time, didn't he, with injury? Well, obviously.
I remember being over the moon when we signed him, thinking, yeah. Wow, because he'd just taken the piss out of Man City in the Champions League, and then he rocks up in Newcastle, then was injured the entire time. The football podcast continues.
the Michael Owen effect, sounds like. I hope it was a good answer to your
I'm sure he was
questions.
Pleased with
I'd
that.
I'd like to point out again that we saw Sabu in... where did we see him?
I saw him in a car when I went to WrestleMania. In the car with Primate. I don't know who else was there. But driving down the road, there was this car with like a Michigan...
You were with Primate?
Yeah, in the car. Yeah,
I'm just imagining
driving.
Sabu and Primate blasting past together. Like, <"Way!"
laughs> No, we're driving down and then this car had Michigan things on it. And Primate was like, oh, wait, look at those Michigan things. And then we looked in the like through the window and all you saw was the nose. And we're like, bloody hell, that's got to be Sabu. Is it Michigan he's from? Have I got that right?
Bombay, Michigan.
Yeah, that's what everyone was putting the pieces together, like Michigan, big nose.
Sabu.
Drugs.
completely unrelated to all that, yes, Sabu was in Long Benton that one time.
Have I told my Iron Sheik story on the podcast? I feel like I have. But me and Sam were at WrestleCon that year in Dallas, and I went, bloody hell, Iron Sheik's over there. And Sam went, that's Sabu. And I was devastated because Sabu must have been having a bit of a bad day. I was so devastated, oof, man. I couldn't... He was looking old. His age had caught up to him a bit.
Thank you for the questions. We very much appreciate them. Got a good selection this week. Fantastic. Thank you. If you have any of your own, please send them to mailbag.com. No, cultaholic@mailbag.com.
Mailbag is cultaholic.
Mailbag.
Reese's Pieces. Hey guys, happy Thanksgiving from the States, y'all. We are very thankful for what you do in 2020. You always keep us laughing and entertained. Today's Reese's Pieces is inspired by Hulk Hogan's upcoming biopic featuring Chris Hemsworth. So that got me thinking, with a little help from the internet, I came up with a list of celebrities that could play wrestlers in future biopics. Well, we know someone who could play the Iron Sheik. I paired some celebrities' personalities with the wrestlers, so it's not purely based off looks. Choose a biopic you like to see. Assume the leftover choice will never happen, and feel free to change any celebrity you want to play the featured wrestler. Have fun. They'll give ourselves some... Christ, there's 12 of these.
Come on!
Oh no, they pretty much explained this, how it goes. They've said who they want to be in it, so I guess we hear that and have to say someone better.
No, just pick which one we want to see.
Oh, no, there's ours. There we go again, the formatting on this. Yeah, I figure it now. Who would you like to see? CM Punk played by Jake Gyllenhaal or Triple H played by Sean Bean?
Sean Bean.
Yeah, Sean Bean.
It's got to be Sean Bean. Have you seen, by the way, the thing where they filmed GoldenEye, the satellite? Some science station. They're finally shutting that down in real life.
Oh, it was actually active?
Yeah. Oh. Not when Sean Bean was falling off it, but...
Oh, Boris is still there, frozen.
Yeah. What's going to do with him? Oh. Cesaro played by Jason Statham. That's a good one. Or Mark Henry played by Rick Ross.
The second one.
I'm picking Jason.
I'm going to... Oh, man. I don't like either of those because the wrestlers are bigger than the people. Like, Cesaro's got a dwarf Jason Statham. I'll go for Jason.
No, I think it'd be like on the same size because Statham was an Olympian.
Oh, was he a diver or something?
Yeah.
Yes.
Shane O'Mac played by Tom Cruise.
That's very good.
Or Stephanie McMahon played by Natalie Portman.
Oh, that's the first one all day long.
Yes.
Absolutely. Can't think of anything funny, but I... Randy Orton played by Daniel Craig.
Oh, similar. I can see it. The mouth, the eyes.
Or William Regal played by Liam Neeson.
What?
I like that one.
Just, yeah, Liam Neeson, yeah.
I'd like to see William Regal played by William Regal. But I'll take Neeson if he's a second option.
Yeah, Neeson is between you and Regal. Orange Cassidy played by Ryan Gosling. or Otis played by Jack Black.
Oh,
I want to see Otis played by Chris Farley if he was still here.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, that's a good one. I'll go for Otis played by Jack Black.
I'll go OC played by Ryan Gosling. This is actually a good one this week. Bret Hart played by Brad Pitt.
What?
Oh, Shawn Michaels played by Harry Styles.
Wait a minute.
As in One Direction Harry Styles.
Yeah.
Oh, watermelon sugar high. That's how it goes, isn't it? Is that the song?
That's the song.
That one.
Neither of those men look anything like them. You could swap them round and it'd be more accurate, I think.
Yeah, Brad Pitt could make a good Shawn Michaels.
Yeah, he could.
Harry Styles could do a good Bret Hart.
Harry Styles could do a good Bret Hart.
Sean Bean could do a good Shawn Michaels these days.
I'll go for...
Bret Hart was a bastard.
I'll go for Brad Pitt as Bret just because I want to see that film, but I don't think there's a resemblance. No.
A movie featuring Simon Miller playing Goldberg or Steve Austin?
Got to be Goldberg, hasn't it?
Yeah.
I'm sure Miller does the spear as part of his arsenal.
Yeah, it's Goldberg.
I can't see Miller doing the Austin voice. I can't do it. But Goldberg shouting, "You're next." I can do that. Yeah. You're
that
next.
Here we go. You John 3:16s? Let me tell you something. I can't do Simon's voice. I can't do it. We need Ben or Peter here because they can do very good Simon Miller impressions.
Austin, why did you pour concrete into my Corvette? Why?
This is very similar to your Wade Barrett.
I'm not good at impressions. We've established.
Fair enough.
If you don't believe me, listen to Cultaholic SmackDown podcast. Mick Foley, played by Zach Galifianakis. Or Owen Hart, played by Owen Wilson.
Oh.
You can see the resemblance there, but I'm going for the first one. The first one, for sure.
I'm going to go for the second one. I think Owen Wilson's a classy choice to play Owen Hart.
Yeah, the second one better than the former. Doing a Mick Foley, because Mick Foley, the guy who's like, hi, you know, I'm very cheap. Anyone, yeah, so I could do that, but like doing the Cactus Jack and all those promos or Mankind, I don't know what I could do that.
Jack Black, but he's already playing Otis.
It's like Jim Carrey doing one of those serious roles.
Wait, do you think Jack Black could be Kenny Omega doing all of his pointing and his dramatic, like...
Yes. Yes, I like that. Jack Black as Kenny Omega.
That'd be so funny.
Yes.
Wayne! Jack Black would...
Wayne! Yeah, Jack Black would have to tone it down, though, to get the Kenny Omega. Right?
Nicolas Cage is Kenny Omega. Oh. There it is.
What's wrong with you, Hangman? You turning on me? Chris Jericho, played by Gordon Ramsay. Oh, okay. Now we're cooking on gas. Or Jon Moxley, played by Ed Sheeran.
Was he joking?
I beg your pardon. The first one, hands down.
Yeah. The first one.
I think he couldn't think of a second one and just had that one so good he knew no one would pick anything else. Young Vince McMahon played by Adam Driver.
Okay.
I hadn't thought about that, but yeah, actually, there's something there with the face. Or older Vince played by Harrison Ford.
Oh, that one.
Yeah, second one.
John Cleese. Adam Driver doing a Young Vince McMahon be good just to see if he can get the inflections. Well, no, 1, 2, 3, he got hard hitting. Punches a wall. There's another one. Or Eric Bischoff played by Bradley Cooper.
He wishes.
I think I'll move on from that one. And for the main event, Roman Reigns played by Jason Momoa. Okay. Or John Cena played by either Matt Damon or Mark Wahlberg.
Mark Wahlberg. Yeah, I was going to say.
I'll go for the Roman.
Yeah, I'll go for the Roman one.
Yeah. That would be good.
We've done it.
Which celeb do you want in your own biopic?
As ourselves?
As ourselves, yes.
Oh, God.
John Candy for me. Everyone says it anyway.
But he was the best, so yeah.
Yeah. It's a nice comparison to have.
Yeah.
I don't know. Can I have one of the other lads out of One Direction? Just not Harry Styles, because he's got curly hair and mine is straight. I really don't know.
I'd have Owen play you.
I'd have Owen play you.
People said, oh, wow, Owen looks like Matthew. I went, what has Owen done to deserve that?
Oh, Matthew, stop. Stop that now. Matthew, your mum listens to this. I'm sure she would tell you that.
Oh, sorry, sorry, mum. I'm way sexier than him. There we go. God, I'll save you 3 phone calls. Well, people keep on comparing me to Keanu Reeves right now, which...
Nice.
I'll go, yeah, but now Keanu Reeves. But I'm still happy with that. You know, John Wick Keanu Reeves, not Bill and Ted Keanu Reeves. And you know what? I'm happy with that. I'm happy with that, as I am with the question that was sent by Kevin Toasty. He says, all the way from the 619, booyaka, booyaka. Don't know what that means.
It's from San Diego.
It's the area code, right? Or the
San Diego, isn't it?
You know what? I've heard that number so many times, I forgot what it actually meant. So if they did Newcastle, it'd be the booyaka, booyaka, 0171.
0191.
Depends on 0171?
What wait.
0191.
Yeah.
Where's 0171?
I forget. Is that all though?
Booyaka, booyaka.
I'm not to put in an area code for, you know, forever. If it's Benwell, it's 999. Here's another Reese's Pieces. So first of all, just want to say you guys have meant the absolute world to me since Name Redacted days, and we're awesome. And you were awesome, I guess, when I met you at the old WCPW days.
And were awesome.
Yes, there's a bad apostrophe there.
Oh, well, thank you very much.
I can't thank you enough for the dark days you got me through. And I'll just, you know, criticise your writing. And for that, I can only say thank you for that and your continued normalisation of men's mental health and speaking out. Anyway, in their words, enough of the soppy balls. So,
well, thanks good. Very much.
Yeah, but first of all, before we go any further, yes, thank you for that. And I think, like, normalising it makes it easier on people, so... Never mind that, though. Here's the soppy balls.
Hope you enjoyed the show as well, if we met him at WCPW.
Yeah, and it wasn't the Sunderland one. I've got some Reese's Pieces for you, gents. On the back of the well-needed Keith Lead theme change, I have a collated list of themes for you to pick. Mario voice, here we go. I can't hit I generally can't hit those notes.
Here we go.
Thank you.
All right.
Christ, sorry.
The designated. When we need someone who hasn't hit puberty, yeah, Jack can do the voice.
Bischoff WWE theme or Vince McMahon theme?
Bischoff for me.
Vince. It's close, though.
Vince is timeless. Go with that. Asuka theme or Sasha Banks theme?
Banks theme.
Asuka's theme.
I can sing along with Sasha Banks' theme, so I'll do that one. Bella's theme or Nia Jax's theme?
Bella's. Specifically, Brie.
Bella's, Nikki.
You know what? I was going to say the Bella's, but now you've reminded me of that one. I'm saying Nia Jax.
Brie mode is an awful song.
I'm not like most girls.
Brie mode.
Edge on This Day by Metal Anus or John Cena, My Time Is Now.
Metal arsehole all day long.
Yeah, I'm going for Steel Rectum as well.
Yeah, I'm going for Edge Booger because that can come on comes on a rise sometimes, doesn't it? So everyone does the hair stroke and go, come on, let me spear you, mate. And you go, nah, get away from me.
Yeah. When he came out of the Rumble and the lyrics made sense, it all fit when he came out this year's Rumble, when he returned.
Yeah, the lyric, it says, I hope that the camera cuts away from me. Chris Jericho, WWE or Judas?
Judas.
I was going to mention this when we talked about Dynamite and I forgot. I'm going for the WWE one because you know what I got sick of this week? I hit the tipping point this week of when Jericho comes out and the Judas plays like for ages and the camera goes around the ringside area and heels, faces, babies, dogs, everyone is singing along to what a great song Judas is, and I'm sick of having it rammed down my throat, so I'm going for the Y2J one.
I'm picking Judas because I like it when the people sing along with it on Dynamite.
Well, just wait a bit, Matthew, because that you will hit that tipping point soon. I've got to say, you will.
Okay.
You mark my words.
CM Punk, Cult of Personality, or Jeff Hardy? No more words.
Cult of Personality.
Jeff Hardy's one, because I preferred Kill Switch for CM Punk.
How does No More Words even go?
Never see the writing on the
wall. Oh, if you're seeing this or hearing this, it's because Ross said a rude word. He's not a fan of that Jeff Hardy song.
Ross was livid about that Jeff Hardy song.
I did an entrance theme tier list last year. I forget who it was with, but I said it on there. I do not like it, and I've nearly caused a third world war, I think. The hate I got for that just by not liking his song. Never liked it.
Undisputed Era or Bobby Roode Glorious?
Glorious.
I'm going for the Undisputed Era, but for a short while, for a glorious few months. Well, for a glorious few months, that was the best thing around. But it's the Undisputed Era.
Yeah, I'm going with Glorious because it's still a great song. And I'm pretty sure it's the thing that's keeping Bobby Roode employed. So.
Oh.
Nakamura, original WWE theme, or Fandango?
Nakamura.
Yeah, Nakamura.
Nah, I remember Fandango mainly being a thing. I'll go with him. Da-na. Undertaker theme or Kane theme? And I'm annoyed by this person because they've not put which Undertaker theme.
Yeah.
What's your favourite Undertaker theme? How about that then, Ross?
My favourite Undertaker theme is called Going Postal, and it's what they used to put on the VHSs when they ran out the rights for Roland, I think it would have been. What a bop that is. And obviously for Kane, it's Slow Chemical, isn't it?
But which of the two?
The Slow Chemical one.
No, no, fire. Which of the two, Undertaker and Kane? Reese's Pieces.
Oh, right, we've got to pick. We're doing picks and then picks on top. Undertaker one, me, I'm a big fan of it. Love it, me. Fair. Called Go and Post, it's called on YouTube.
I'll go for American Badass by Kid Rock, but then I'll go for Kane's overall, because it's a classic. Slow Chemical.
Okay. I'll go with Undertaker's Ministry of Darkness one, the WF Volume 4, the one with the sleigh bells. He's speaking like fake Latin at the start, because I thought that was the coolest thing. Kane's first theme with the organ build-up.
Ooh.
That got me. That was like, oh, Kane's coming. You know, the arena lights go off and it's like, Oh, they're both really good.
I've just ruined Cultaholic lore forever. My favourite theme of all time, according to the lore, is you've done it now, you've got to make a big mistake.
Yes.
I did wonder where Going Postal came from, I might, but
pissed it all away.
Yeah.
Time to leave, I think.
It's almost like you've done it now. You made a big mistake.
God. Ruined it.
By the way, on the color SmackDown thing, me and Tom do, that replaces on the network the Kid Rock.
That's
and
it.
And I've had to like completely overdub it and the crowd noise. So I'm like, I swear the crowd were way more into it.
You've done it now.
And the like the thing in the corner comes up, like, you can buy the new album, comes up, and it's just blurred. Anyway. I'm going to go with Ministry of Darkness because it's tough though. Goldberg theme or Stone Cold theme? Ooh.
The Disturbed Stone Cold theme.
The non-Disturbed Stone Cold theme.
WCW Goldberg. Such a good song. DX theme or The Rock theme?
DX.
If we're going... like back when it was back then, 90s, then DX. But if I like the big epic rock ones with the big guitar solos and stuff, so I'll go for the rock's more modern themes.
DX, the Run DMC, the King of Rock, what? The King of Rock, who?
I've been listening to Aggression on loops all week long. I have. I put it out a tweet to Wale, which he ignored, saying we need to bring back Aggression in 2020. I thought me and Wale were life friends, like me and David Arquette, but it turns out no.
Oh, Wally still likes you, surely.
Not heard from him in a while.
He likes you, but he preferred the WWE original CD. Shawn Michaels or Eddie Guerrero?
Shawn Michaels is timeless, isn't it?
Yeah, I agree with that.
Shawn Michaels, because you can't dance to Eddie Guerrero's theme at 1 in the morning at Raw.
You can't trip over, though, when everyone's sticking their legs out like Shawn doing the pose.
Eat your heart out, girls. Big fat dudes doing that. It's great.
Although, the guitar solo works really well in what is effectively an 80s, like, terrace.
Yeah. But you know what? Maybe I say Eddie Guerrero because they should play it once. They loop it. And like, oh, okay, three. Yeah. Ric Flair theme or Sting's WCW theme?
Sting.
Probably Ric Flair.
Oh, they're both great, but Sting Crow theme.
It's got to be Starrcade as well with a bit at the start.
What do you mean?
The thing, the tarp in the sky with the white outline Sting doing the woman doing the voiceover.
Oh.
Nope, Starrcade 97 entrance.
I remember him coming out looking bored, which was a big major issue people have talked about for years. MVP original theme or Mark Henry theme?
Mark Henry Echo. What a big one, that the one he had when he was against Undertaker WrestleMania 22, the casket match.
Wait,
what?
But it's the original theme you've got to pick.
Is it? I thought I could pick any.
I thought that's what Matthew said.
So MVP's original, which is I'm Coming.
Yeah. I'm Coming. Or Mark Henry.
Is it
say MVP,
Mark
your tea's ready. I'm Coming.
Does it say Mark Henry original, or is it?
It just Mark says Henry? Mark Henry theme.
Oh, sorry.
It's left ambiguous.
Sorry.
So I've gone for the Echo Mark Henry theme.
I'll go for MVP's for how funny it is.
Mark Henry. Oh, someone's going to get their wig split.
Whoa. Hey.
3-6 Mafia!
Randy Orton, new or old theme?
Old, hey! old. Jesus Christ, the new ones are awful.
Oh, God. Harsh.
Terrible.
Harsh on voices. But I'll go with Burning My Light.
Yeah, I know that Randy Orton hated it, but
Take
I liked it.
Why did Randy Orton hate it, did he say?
I forget. It was some off comment he made about, like, it sounded like some sort of High School Musical song. And that's it. I know this may be a little long, but I'm dossing off work to send this one. Good. Hope you guys are doing good and can give a day one fan a hello.
Hello.
I was going to say 3-2-1, we'll do a hello. 3-2-1.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm not playing your Tom Campbell games on this podcast, Matthew. I'll say hello when I want.
Okay.
Sorry, that was really...
That's from Ton from Stoke-on-Trent.
By saying... Thank you very much, by the way. By saying your Tom Campbell games, I didn't...
I know what you meant.
I just meant being inclusive and nice, I think, is what I meant.
Oh, right. Yeah. That's a Tom Campbell game. I mean, you are right. You know, he's very good.
Yeah.
You know what else is right?
Oh,
the fact that
the
anyone can send their Reese's Pieces to us. mailbag@cultaholic.com. And we'll try our best not to make fun of them if they're too long. Honest.
It's Cultaholics.
Big question.
Wow. What a great podcast. Until this moment. Because of the lack of things happening in the world of wrestling, we're struggling to come up with what the big question is. That's the big question where we name this title of the video something, and then lots of people... put the comment in the YouTube section what they want, or comment, and then they don't watch to this point. So it doesn't really matter what we put in. Because I've seen the thumbnail, but we've decided, as manly men, men of taste, men of questionable fashion sense, we should finally discuss and figure out who is the most attractive male wrestler in wrestling.
Ever, mind.
Ever. And you can tell we're invested in this because Ross is on his phone.
No, I'm just finding out what the general consensus is online. Because I'm quite intrigued.
Can we guess some general names at first? Can we guess who people think is? Because I'm going to throw out there.
I want you to try and guess who the fourth Google search image result is.
Fourth?
The fourth one on there.
What is the search?
The sexiest male wrestler of all time.
Is it Randy Orton?
No, it's not.
Oh, of all time? Oh, I don't know. Dick the Bruiser's still got his
face. No, Dick the Bruiser's not.
Dick the Bruiser?
I love that name.
Is it Shawn Michaels?
He's actually the first result.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, he's a sexy boy.
Given what I read on Twitter, Adam Cole.
Incorrect.
I'm going to show you, otherwise we might be here all day long.
Finn Balor. Okay.
This is the fourth result.
Oh, I mean.
Shamrock.
Ken Shamrock is the fourth. There's your top four, just in case you're wondering. But Michaels, John Cena, the game.
Bloody hell.
With the title around it. That's it. That's why he held it for so long. Makes sense.
Power is attractive, so, you know, you've got to have that.
But who is the sexiest male wrestler of all time?
Okay. I think there's a strong case to be made for mid-90s Shawn Michaels, surely. Surely. Mm-hmm.
What, when you dress like a stripper?
Yeah, yeah.
Little hat.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Oh, Shawn, you're so hot. And then he'd speak, he's like, hi.
Maybe Orton as well, but he's a bit too extreme looking for me, like... He's got a... Oh.
Look at that.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
he thinks Shawn. He's cute. He knows he's sexy.
He's got his towel on in bed. He must have wet the bed. It's Shawn Michaels, everybody.
Well, you've ruined Shawn now. It's not him.
I don't like Randy Orton because he looks like most...
It's the lads having a celebration in the dressing room.
What is this segment?
What are you Googling?
It's just sexiest male wrestlers, and there's Triple H and Batista popping the bubbly in the dressing room.
Why has someone added a sparkle filter over it?
I think it's the champagne.
Are they vampires?
It's Batista's. Batista's popped the cork in the background there. Look, it's the champagne.
Oh, if you know what I mean. What was I trying to say? Yeah, Randy Orton looks like too much like the main character in an FPS in the 2010s.
Yes, he does. He's got a bit of modern. Action hero about
sexy
it.
Red Kev.
What's going on, Ross? Here,
it's sexy
What's
Kev. Sexy Kev.
I don't want to know who that is.
Shouts Roman Reigns, current day Roman Reigns.
That's a very good shout.
It's godlike. It's got to the stage where he's got the new mouth and he's got the full beard in, which I prefer personally, and the reduced body fat percentage, I guess, I've got to throw in there as well. Roman Reigns these days is godlike.
He's looking incredible, and. You can. It's like, have you seen It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia where Dennis gets too full of himself and he's a gold. I'm a golden god. It's like that. He's
like
too
last week's
handsome.
Podcast.
For God's sake.
So we cut that out and say, this is what Jack really thinks. It's gonna be shouting, I'm a golden god.
Roman's Matthew, a great show.
Matthew, are you going for? We've got Michaels and we've got Roman.
Matthew's gonna come out with some rogue pick here.
Falder.
He's going to go mad.
Hey, they call him the Big Daddy for some reason. No.
I'm excited to see what type of man Matthew goes for here. Was he going to go for a pretty boy or a manly man?
Honestly, though, like, I know people, it's considered fashionable and stuff and that, but not a lot of wrestlers I look at and go, wow, they're attractive.
Wow, your standards are ridiculous then.
No, I mean, that's it, though. What people go for is not what I say. I'm like, oh, look at that.
Well, yeah, true. I get what you mean.
I wouldn't get any bloody work done if I was there watching them going, oh. Oh, I'm trying to get gone. I hope you kick out again. But the vinegar strokes.
God. Oh, my God.
I'd say somebody, what gets me is passion.
Okay.
The stuff. So that's why a lot of like wrestlers there's absolutely nothing for it. I don't care how sexy or well built they are. If they come out and go, I am going to beat you, fire crotch, I'm like, I don't care.
Oh,
about
no,
you,
I know
who
he's going to go for. Ross, I can tell who he's going to go for already.
Oh, go on.
He's going for Eddie Kingston straight away.
Mate, wow.
You said,
that'd be great. He finally catches up with me and he just kisses us. I'm going to go with. Because the passion, the man is just unlimited passion.
Buff Bagwell.
Shut up, I'll kill you, bro.
He's now thinking of a different one.
No.
He was going to say Eddie Kingston. Now he's pretending that he
wasn't.
He's going to now say a different one.
I'm going to say Xavier Woods.
You've made that up. You've just plucked that. You were going to say Eddie Kingston. No, that's true. Woods is very passionate about a lot of things, to be fair.
Yeah.
And he's a handsome
passionate
man.
Passionate is creative. He stands out from these people going out, grr, I'm going to beat you up at the next WWE licensed pay-per-view. Grr. He comes out and he's like, I'm going to play my brass instrument, whatever. I'm going to play my games. I'm going to dress up. I'm going to do presenting. I'm going to do a podcast. He'll probably do a film next. He'll probably become the mayor of whichever state he wants to pick. I think that's what works in America. Passion. Passion for something is what gets me because not a lot of people have it. That's why I'm having this podcast with you two sexy individuals.
Thank you.
I know good people in this place, like Tom Campbell and Andrew, another who we did something with this past week. And he was a lovely human being. And he didn't know anything about wrestling. By the way,
Andrew,
he didn't know dick about. Wait. He didn't know dick about 2000 wrestling because he wasn't watching it. He didn't know who the. We said, who's the first King of the Ring? He went, Jeff Hardy. He went, do you know what? You know who Chris Benoit is? And he went, no, I've never. What did he do? I went, doesn't matter. But he knew, oh, that referee's Teddy Long. He used to manage Rodney Mack. Hanging out with passionate people like yourselves, newer people are Cultaholic. And
what's
all the
this become, Matthew?
Fans.
All we asked you was who's the sexiest wrestler, and you've turned it into an inspirational speech. You're a better person than
I've been
than
drinking
we are.
The Tom Campbell juice.
So yeah,
let's forget about good personal traits. You don't know anything about these people.
All right.
You're just, everyone's in the lineup, and you've got to pick.
You've just dragged it way back down.
You've got to pick one. You've got to pick one to take home for the night, Matthew. Who are you taking home?
God, it's a bloody meat market. of all time.
The sexiest wrestler of all time. We're going to get horrible comments for objectifying these male superstars, aren't we?
No, absolutely.
Do you know who's up there?
I was
going to
go deep. What's that?
Do you know who's really up there? It's a mixture of Ross's brutal shallowness and Matthew's metaphysical poetry. Big E combines passion and attractiveness in a good little package, doesn't he?
Because, a little package. Yeah. I don't think so.
Oh no!
This is just Italian Nine Darts show, isn't it? At this point,
I like this reply to that. Someone shared the clip and he replied with like a, "Oh, I did it," you know. Oh.
Biggie's hilarious. Everyone knows that humor is attractive. Biggie also has preposterous muscles. Look at all that tricep meat. I think that might be my answer. You know,
I think that should be the thumbnail. Really,
the thumbnail should just be his pecs.
Yeah.
That'll get demonetized, I reckon.
Worth it.
So there we have it. Big E is the sexiest wrestler of all time.
We've solved it. I can't believe it.
Also, shout out to Finn Balor's Thirst Picks, aka his main Twitter account.
Balor makes me feel terrible about myself. He's an awfully well-built man.
No, life must be boring. If you're that strict on yourself, I say.
Maybe it's a ballot.
Imagine never eating carbs. Never.
I know. You're right.
If it's looking like Balor or Calzone.
Oh, right. Okay.
You know, it's like,
I love a Calzone. Yeah. Fair. Well, this has been absolutely brilliant.
This is the podcast.
This is the actual big question. Pacini's going to see it and go, lads, I can't believe you didn't mention me.
Pacini's undergone what the kids call a glow-up in the past few years, I believe. He's, you know, his hair's been... Yeah, he started getting fades on his hair and that. It looked good.
He goes to the Turkish barbers in the middle of town, so he does.
Does he?
I'm
scared of a Turkish barber. When people have told me the stories of the Turkish barbers, they've said that they get really close when they shave you and stuff, and they're very they know what they're doing, but it's a bit scary. I've never been to one.
I went once and I had the flame stuff done to get rid of all the little hairs on the side of your head, so they just get a stick with a flame and go full on Sabu around the side of your head, and I was like, whoa.
On Sabu, so they're going, cheeky baby.
No.
That might be one of my favourite moments of Cultaholic podcast, just that one moment, by the way. I went to the Turkish barbers as well, and they did the haircut in about 5 minutes. I went, bloody hell, that's amazing, that. Wow, no wonder there's such a prestigious term, the Turkish barbers.
Yeah.
Then I went a few weeks later and said, I could have this type of haircut that was different than the first haircut I got. And I got the exact same haircut again. I went, oh, that's why it's so quick. You don't want bloody style. But if you want that haircut, then absolutely go there. In and out like a bank job. Rather like the people watching this video, I imagine. 3 minutes into it, wondering why people why we're not talking about wrestlers' cocks.
3 hours.
Thank you very much for enduring the fantastic Cultaholic Wrestling Podcast. Hope you've enjoyed it as much as we have talking about it. Ross, what have you got for us this week on the channel?
Myself and Sam are doing a tier list ranking on all of the Undertaker's gimmicks. We've narrowed it down to 9 gimmicks over the past 30 years. Ooh. And that video is a lot longer than you might expect.
Because Sam and his mom, they love The Undertaker.
Oh, I hope Cameo Undertaker is
Cameo Undertaker is the ninth gimmick.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah. Got to put it on there. It's straight in the top tier. Is it the best gimmick of all time? They'll find out on this tier, on that tier list ranking.
I hear you're 91. That's awesome.
The best is like, give your mum a special hug from The Undertaker.
Jack, do you have any special hugs for the viewers?
Nothing out of the ordinary. So rest of the week, me and Owen are still doing Twitch streams every Wednesday from 6 p.m. and Dynamite graded on a Wednesday. I can't think of anything at the minute. What about you, Matthew?
Just the Twitch thing on 6 p.m. Saturday. That's GMT time. Figure out for yourselves, everybody else. I don't know what we'll be doing because whatever I say will happen will not happen due to my PC. And there's also the Cultaholic SmackDown review of me and Tom Campbell. Assistance from Mr. Andrew this week. And I guess until Owen comes back or sorts you out, people have no choice but to wait until next week and send their votes for the Hall of Fame.
There's no point. There's not going to be another podcast after that.
Cultaholic. Or mailbag.com for...
right, patreon.com/cultaholic and mailbag@cultaholic.com. Thanks, guys. Thanks, yes. Matthew.
Thank
Thanks,
you. Send condolences to there for the Jeff podcast. And as always, we put our hands towards the webcams. I count to three. Say the magic phrase. 1, 2, 3.
Join us.